throughout the South, they call it the worst in memory. This afternoon at the world's fastest speedway, as hot as the track, is this man, Bill Elliott, back on the pole with a new record and his sights again set on devastating the field. CBS Sports presents live flag-to-flag coverage of the Talladega 500. It is hot at Talladega, Alabama, and the race will be the same. The only salvation right now is a gentle breeze caressing some 100,000 gathered to see this great spectacle. We're anticipating the races of the entire Winston Cup schedule here at Talladega, Alabama. Hello, I'm Ken Squier, and CBS flag-to-flag coverage of this event about to begin with Bill Elliott up in front, flanking him through 188 laps, 500 miles of competition for a purse of $500,000 today. Now already this heat is causing some rather unusual things in this race. After some 16 to 18 laps under green, they're going to put a caution field in to check tires. NASCAR being extremely careful here because of the excessive heat. Working alongside is the two-time Grand National Champion, Ned Jarrett.
Well, thank you, Ken, and good afternoon, everyone. Even though this is the fastest racetrack on the circuit, most drivers will tell you that it is the easiest to drive because of the wide sweeping turns and the high banks. Horsepower is a key to getting around here. Case in point, Ronnie Thomas qualified on Thursday here at 196 miles an hour in his regular, not have made the field. He rented an engine from Richard Petty, next day qualified at 201 miles an hour, some 5 miles an hour faster. But you can be lulled to sleep if you aren't careful here. Get a false sense of security because it is so easy to drive. But if you ever get in trouble here, you really get in trouble. So you have to concentrate, even though sometimes it's hard to do, on not getting into trouble.
Juan Important did not start for this race. 1980, Talladega 500 champion last week at Pocono, Pennsylvania. Slammed the retainer 160 miles per hour, broke three ribs, punctured a lung, broke his shoulder blade. And so he's out of the race, and he's with us today. I'm delighted to have another member of the Alabama gang, Neil Bonnett, along. Davey Allison's taking over for you, and this is sort of like deja vu. It was a few years ago when Bobby Allison crashed severely up in Minnesota, and you took over for him.
Yeah, I qualified Bobby's car at Nashville, was able to run the race, and I got injured last week. Thank goodness he's doing a heck of a job. Hope he has a good race today.
What about this race?
It's going to be tough. This place produces a lot of different winners. The track does, not the race cars. A car that's the fastest race car is not necessarily going to win. The big shuffle at the end of this race, a guy in eighth place can come up and win the race.
Indeed. Now let's go to the human interest story of this race. Here's Mike Joy.
Davey Allison is strapping into his Junior Johnson Chevrolet in relief of Neil Bonnett, getting the radio gear and the cool hat hooked up. And even the helmet has cooling vents on its side to make this 100-degree day just a little bit cooler. You're lucky. At least you're going to get a breeze out there.
Well, you know, this little cool suit's supposed to help. I've tried one before, but today will be a new experience for me in a couple of different ways, it looks like.
Speaking of new experiences, Junior Johnson doesn't have a driver signed for next year. This sure is a heck of an audition opportunity for you.
Well, I'm just going to go out and do the best I can do, and I'm looking for a ride for next year, and I know Junior's looking for a driver, so maybe I'll be one of the candidates after today.
Well, Ken, the best he can do should be pretty good. He has won races here, and he finished 10th in this event last year. Let's go up to the front of pit road where it's really hot with a 209-mile. Chris Economaki.
Well, here's the man of the moment, Bill Elliott, on the pole again. Bill, everybody from Georgia is smiling today. You're back up front where you were last year at this time, but you had some problems earlier this year. You went downhill, your brother was sick, and there was talk of trouble on the team, but now you're back on top. What's brought you back up top?
Well, it's a combination of things. You know, really, we hadn't been down that much. they've just had a lot of bad luck as far as not finishing races, and that was our key point last year, as we did finish races. And I just hope the car finishes today.
Confident?
Very much so.
Okay, there's Bilal on the pole, Ken.
It is truly the most competitive field I remember in the 18-year history of this Talladega 500 that's now getting set to set sail for some 180 laps of bruising competition today. So stand by with us here on CBS.
The Talladega 500 from the Alabama International Motor Speedway is sponsored by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? Budweiser, Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. For you, and by Wrangler, a legend in jeans, made in the USA.
Like many before, you came here asking for just one thing.
Sadowski. Shabowski.
A chance.
Pronounce Shabowski.
You're gonna make it here, cause you make America work.
Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste.
Hey, Sid.
That says Budweiser.
This Bud's for you.
Have you driven a Ford? When was the last time you had the kind of car to bring the road alive?
Have you driven a Ford? And you don't know.
If you think physical fitness can help you get ahead in business, subscribe to the Wall Street Journal and see what mental fitness can do.
Call 800-2500 for this special introductory offer. 13 weeks for just $29.50 with a money-back guarantee. 13 weeks, $29.50. Phone 800-2500 now for the Wall Street Journal.
Don't you know me? I'm your native son.
Willie and Wrangler, a legend in jeans.
I'll be gone 500 miles.
Made in the USA.
Is done.
Here is the starting lineup for the 18th annual Talladega 500. On the pole at 209 plus miles per hour, a new record for the race, Bill Elliott in his Ford Thunderbird. Dale Earnhardt will start second, the 83 and 84 winner in his Chevrolet. For row two, from Ashland, Ohio, Tim Richmond. He's won three of his last four races, and Benny Parsons in an Oldsmobile. For row three, determined dark horse Sterling Marlin and Kyle Petty. In row four, replacing Neil Bonnett in the Junior Johnson car, it's Davey Allison, and alongside is Rick Wilson. For row five, Terry Labonte in an Oldsmobile, and Jeff Bodine, the Daytona 500 winner, in his Chevrolet. Row six is Supertech's A.J. Foyt, and the 75 winner of this race, Buddy Baker. Row seven, Bobby Hillen Jr. from Midland, Texas, in a Buick, and Morgan, North Carolina. In row eight, it's Darrell Waltrip, the 79 and 82 champion, and Phil Parsons in an Oldsmobile. Row number nine, from West Virginia, comes Rodney Combs, and from Wisconsin, Jim Sauter. In row 10, defending champion, Cale Yarborough. Alongside is the Bud Moore Ford of Ricky Rudd. In row number 11, the 71 winner of the race, and winner here in May, Bobby Allison, and flanking him, Rusty Wallace from St. Louis. Row 12, Upland, California's Joe Ruttman, and the 74 Talladega winner, Richard 13. From Ozona, Texas, Chet Phillip and Tommy Ellis of Richmond, Virginia. Row 14, Pittsburgh, Massachusetts, Ron Bouchard, and the leading rookie in the race, Alan Kulwicki from Wisconsin. Row 15, Del McCoward from Georgia, and Phil Barkdahl from Phoenix, Arizona. Row 16, Harry Gant, the Bandit, and Poncho Carter from Brownsburg, Indiana. Row 17, Michael Waltrip, the brother out of Owensboro, Kentucky, and Ken Schrader from Missouri. Row 18 is Ronnie Thomas from Virginia and Buddy Arrington, also from Virginia. Row 19, Eddie Bierswale of San Antonio, Texas, and Jimmy Smut Means of Huntsville, Alabama. Rounding out the field, row 20, Ken Reagan from Unadilla, Georgia, and the 1976 Talladega champion, Dave Marcus. The field about to go under starter's orders here for the Talladega 500. Alabama Congressman Bill Nichols will give the command to fire the engines as the Grand Marshal of the 1986 Talladega 500. 20-year veteran of the U.S. House, a very popular man here from Sylacauga, Alabama, right next door.
In the pit area, please get back behind the fence.
Clearing the final folks back from along the pit road. Some of the mechanics taking a little extra time here today. There you see the tri-oval area and the pit road with the 40 cars that will be addressing this track for 500 miles this afternoon. Bill Elliott on the pole at 209 miles per hour, a new record for this course. He had the record a year ago at 207.5. Average speed of the field, 104 miles per hour, and that too is a record. The entire area through the tri-oval packed to capacity, tremendous infield.
Thank you, Don. Great to be in Talladega this afternoon and to participate in the running of the Talladega 500. I especially appreciate being here on a day when we honor a great governor of the state of Alabama, Governor George Wallace. It was my pleasure many years ago to introduce Bill France to George Wallace, and it's been a great relationship ever since. So it's good to be here, Don, and I'm anxious to get this race underway. The weather's perfect, and whenever you say, let me know.
Now, for the time-honored words, Congressman Bill Nichols.
Gentlemen, start your engines. There's a
crowd on their feet. Field fires. The moment in motorsports.
Can perhaps express that as well as anybody can.
I tell you what, this runtime right now, you know, with me being from Alabama, to see, give that command and these 100,000 people stand up and appreciate the sport the way they do, sitting there ready to put on a good show for them, wanting to get going.
Weather today, it's going to be just incredible inside those cars. You're inside Bobby Allison's car for a moment. It has rained almost every afternoon this week, with the exception, I believe, of one on four or five. They expect to get this race in. A native this morning told me, he said it was so hot that the robins on his lawn were using pot holders to get their worms. That's an Alabama story.
You got to watch them in Alabama. They'll tell you a story.
Bobby Allison coming out. He won here in May. Senior member of the Alabama gang, going to work for the Stavola brothers this afternoon. And now you're looking with him down into turn number one. Field rolling out, everybody looking strong. We'll be back with the action from Talladega, Alabama, the Talladega 500 in a moment.
You see, today is tomorrow in Japan. So when you come for Clark tomorrow, it will be today.
Life takes a time, remember. Rome wasn't built in a day.
Take it to Midas.
At Midas, we can replace mufflers, brake shocks, or struts on most foreign cars, and we won't take all day to do it. Time is money.
Take it to Midas.
If I'd wanted it tomorrow, old chap, I wouldn't be here today.
Take it to someone you trust.
Stereo television. Once you hear how great it sounds on a Zenith, you'll think we invented it. We did. Zenith. Quality.
Why is my antacid Tums? Tums is effective. It neutralizes one-third more stomach acid than the other leading brand. And Tums is rich in calcium. To me, that's extra good news. Tums.
Speed. Heat. Endurance. The triple test of NASCAR racing. Quaker State Motor Oil is here, performing, protecting, flowing continuously under extreme conditions. And it's the same oil you can buy right off the shelf. Quaker State technology delivers protection in your car and on the track.
Quaker State, the big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will.
Comfy shoes and funky blues and Mars roasted almonds. These are some of the best things in life. Reading Sunday funnies on your tummies and Mars buttery caramel. Store hopping, good time shopping and Mars rich chocolate. These are some of the best things in life.
It's the little rewards that make life great. Mars Bar, one great little reward.
Some of the best things in life.
Field in their last preliminary lap before the start of the Talladega 500. Our in-car cameras lie with Rusty Wallace this afternoon, Bobby Allison, and Harry Gant. Harry Gant, Ken Squier at CBS Control. Can you hear me, Harry? Harry Gant, Ken Squier, do you read me? Well, we're having an audio problem reaching Harry right now as he goes down that long 3,000-foot back straightaway. Next time through there at better than 200 miles an hour. Remember, this entire field under a blanket at over 204 miles per hour. Prediction on this race, Neil Bonnett?
Well, I tell you, Ken, this is one place you don't want to predict a winner because it's thrown some guys out that were long shots, and the guy that's supposed to win doesn't always do it here. So there's about 12 or 14 potential winners out there right now.
Rusty Wallace, in-car camera from the number 27 car. He's a strong candidate. Remember, this is the dark horse race. Ned, prediction from you?
It's so hard to tell, Ken. Certainly handling has plays an effect here, but horsepower is such a key factor in getting the brakes in the race.
If there's one young man out here that I think could be the one to pull it off in the dark horse tradition of Talladega, it's Bobby Hillen, 22 years old. He's had 2/4 and 1/3 on the big super speedways this year. They give them an Alabama send-off as they come to the tri-oval. Again, start-finish line, 400 feet. Beyond this tri-oval, the most dangerous part of the track right there. Harold Kinder, flag in hand, sends them on their way. Lap one of 188, wheel to wheel. It's the Ford Thunderbird on the inside of Bill Elliott from Dawsonville, Georgia, and Dale Earnhardt. And now they crawl through three deep as they head into the back straightaway.
Tim Richmond wasted no time in moving right around the leaders as they race side by side.
Richmond, who's having just a tremendous time in his career right now with Harry Hyde. And there goes Sterling Marlin on the inside for second place, challenging Dale Earnhardt on the outside. At better than 200 miles an hour, 33-degree banking. Earnhardt pushed all the way to the wall. Down to the inside, the white and yellow car, Jeff Bodine, winner at Daytona, trying to find some running room. First lap going in the record book. Down they come, and as they scream through this, Sterling Marlin makes a move. It is Marlin going in front, Earnhardt in the second. Also climbing up on the inside now, Benny Parsons is challenging in third position. And they're three deep back there in the fourth, fifth, and sixth positions.
Surprisingly, Elliott has fallen back to about seventh or eighth place, Ken. Whether his car just didn't respond to the takeoff, he was even with Earnhardt going into the first turn. But then after they started shuffling around, he's dropping back in the pack.
Sterling Marlin, a sensational driver. His dad, Cuckoo Marlin, the alfalfa farmer from Columbia, Tennessee, who was on the Winston Cup circuit for nearly two decades himself. A lot of potential in this young man that is driving for Haas Ellington in car number one. To the tri-oval turn. Number five with this tri-oval track. Now they come across the line. And here's the challenge. Bodine is moving on the inside now. It's Jeff Bodine sneaking along the bottom of the racetrack. Bodine into third, challenging Earnhardt now in second. Incredible speeds beginning to clamber up on the back straightaway.
Neil, you must reach, what, 212 or 215 on the back straight?
We put the radar guns over 217 every now and then in one of these good fast laps.
What about in a draft like this with 18 guys in a choo-choo train?
I'll tell you what, they're seeing a good 212, 215 down through there. Sterling seems awful strong right now. When Earnhardt doesn't pass him, Sterling's got to be stout.
Coming back to the tri-oval another time. Here comes the challenge. It's Earnhardt trying to move to the inside. He's there along with him. Comes the 1986 Daytona 500 champion, Jeff Bodine. Parsons watching and also moving up. That orange car that is running fifth is Rick Wilson. Rick Wilson up to fifth position.
Here's a young driver out of Bartow, Florida that doesn't have a great deal of experience, but he likes the high-speed racetracks.
Kyle Petty has moved into sixth. Challenge for the lead. Bottom of the racetrack, the number five, the Rick Hendrick car. Hendrick not here today, injured yesterday in his dock at home. Hurt some toes, so he's watching this event back in Charlotte, North Carolina. And he's seeing his challenger, Jeff Bodine, go out in front. There's Elliott further back. Chris Economaki has a report to the Elliott pit.
Well, Ernie Elliott is standing here talking with Bill Elliott, who's dropped to 12th place by the second lap. He said there's no news to report. He seems calm, but he is talking rather extensively with Bill Elliott. Apparently, there's a problem of one sort or another with that pole winning number nine. Back to you, Ken.
Do you believe it's a problem, Ned, or is he waiting on this field?
I would guess the problem with the chassis is a little bit looser than he might want it, Neil, but Kyle Petty is off the pace, and the car number seven had a good qualifying run here. But Elliott dropping back this early, Neil, would you think maybe the chassis is a little bit looser than he wants to run in that heavy traffic?
Yeah, it probably is, and Bill's the type of guy with the kind of equipment that he's not going to be concerned about taking any chances now. He'll probably wait to adjust to that car, and he'll go back to the front when he feels comfortable.
Bill Parsons is on the move, up to eight from 16th. The only pole winner to ever win this race was Dave Marcus in 1976. Dropping
and A.J. Foyt is having problems in car number 14.
A.J. just coming by us and falling almost into the tail end of the field. Leaders now working lap six. There you see Bodine in first, as you saw him through so much with Earnhardt challenging. And the Ellington car, Sterling Marlin, maintaining third. Getting a lap time for this circulation of the 2.6 mile 33 to High Bank track in the trioval, banked only 17, and the cars really get skittish here. We'll talk to Ned about that in a moment. Running this lap down 47.2. That is really getting with the program.
That's well over 202 miles an hour, almost 203 miles an hour. That is fast for competition laps.
Now remember, if we stay green, we may see them coming on pit road, yellow flag, lap 16 or 17 here now.
There has been concern about the tires in this heat and the speeds that they are running here. There's a tremendous amount of pressure on the tires on a track like this. Neil?
I think the reason you see it.
Here's Mike Joy.
A.J. Foyt is on pit road. This is unexpected. The tires they'll put on the car are scuffs. Those are tires that they've run a few laps of practice on. Putting right sides on A.J.'s car. He is gesturing, but he doesn't appear to be too upset. It could be just a tire imbalance. Nope. They're looking at the lap stick. Hutchinson says, nope. Send him out. Let's see if we can get a comment from Dick on the problem. Dick Hutchinson, why'd you have to bring him in?
He felt like he got a cut tire someplace, so we're just changing the right side to see if we can catch it.
So Foyt is back out in the race, but he's lost valuable ground.
In fact, he lost one left, Mike Joy, and that's going to be awfully hard to make up.
Sure is. I think what you're seeing, Ned, at the front of this pack, when they know there's 16 left, they're going to check these tires. Maybe Bill and some of these guys, there's no reason to string it out because they're going to close it back up as soon as they do that.
Earnhardt on the inside, regaining the lead. Earnhardt sideways and gathers it up. He had the wind coming through. That's a great way to cool off, but a terrible way to get through a corner. Earnhardt sideways for just a moment. And look at them, three deep behind it.
Well, if anybody can pull it out of a situation like that, Dale Earnhardt can.
I tell you one thing it does. It gives you a little breathing room. They'll back off the throttle and give you some room.
They certainly will. They have time. We're going to look in replay. Look at this battle for second. Meanwhile, let's take a look at what happened right here. Coming into the lead.
It looked like the air off the front of Bodine's car just sucked the rear of his car around. Neil, is that a fair assumption?
That's right, Ned. But, you know, you're probably dealing with one guy right there out of that bunch is capable of doing it. There's several drivers can do it, but Dale does that all day long. He's pretty good at it.
That's exactly the kind of move that lost Don McTavish his life in 1969. He overcorrected by about a half an inch and went head-on into the wall at Daytona. You really have to know what you're doing at these tremendous speeds. Or it could be tragic.
Well, Bodine's not too content in sitting back there in second place, I don't believe.
Bodine wants a piece of that lead. And remember, this is the old confrontation. Bodine against Earnhardt. Earnhardt looking really stout now with nine laps complete, working lap 10. Earnhardt said the other day on a shorter track, this is typical Earnhardt, I don't know if I have the power to get by him, but I know I have the power to get to his rear bumper. And it it's that kind of an attitude on the part of Earnhardt that's making a lot of drivers give him a lot of room. And look at Labonte, number 44, Texas Terry Labonte, on the outside. Rim rides his way up into third spot.
And Modine's car is not staying down. As you see him go into the corners, he's losing three or four or five car lengths to Earnhardt each time they go into the turns. We're watching now as he comes through the tri-oval. But when he goes into turn number one, Earnhardt is able to stay right down on the low side of the racetrack. However, somebody was there that time. He couldn't stay down there. And it was Modine. Modine did keep it down and make the pass, but look at Labonte.
Look at the 1984 NASCAR stock car champion Terry Labonte down to the inside. His dad working in his pits this afternoon has got to be thrilled about this. Three wide for the lead at 200 miles per hour into turn three. Give it to Earnhardt.
And Sterling Marlin comes right with him.
Richard Petty has moved from 24th to 13th. Interval first to 12th, 1 3/10 of a second. That's racing.
I'll tell you what people don't think about. One thing you get kind of greedy in that race car, it's already full temperature. Those cars are up to the heat inside the car. Out running, front of leading this race, it's a lot cooler. Every position back, you pick up a little bit of temperature. It's also greed, wanting to get some of that cool air to breathe.
Neil Bonnett, does it look a whole lot different up here than it does down there?
Yeah, but I kind of like the looks of that windshield better than this. I'd like to be in there with it.
Sure you would. Neil Bonnett, three broken ribs, a punctured lung, a busted up shoulder. When do you expect to get back into a race car?
Just the minute the doctor says I might be able to, I'll be in there.
Buddy Arrington about to be overlapped. There's a story there on that number 67. A tragic story this year. He's trying to get it all gathered up again this year, and we'll tell you about that as the afternoon continues. Look at Earnhardt moving away, and I'll tell you the guy that's impressing me right now is Rick Wilson out of Bartow, Florida. He's not giving an inch to anybody. Staying fifth.
He's staying right in the middle of the battle. He and Sterling Marlin both are young riders. Don't mind mixing it up.
Battle for the lead one more time. On the inside, Labonte going for it. What a performance. Remember, Labonte is being talked about as the new driver for Junior Johnson. Out of turn number two, he has Earnhardt under control for the moment. Third place car. Sterling Marlin maintains that position with the number one.
And he's dropped back just a little bit. Now Bodine's going to try to move around him. There are a couple of the cars that are having trouble keeping down on the low side of the racetrack. Marlin is one of those. We see Earnhardt. His car seems to work wherever he wants to go, because if he needs to go high coming off the turn, he takes it out there and it works. And if he needs to stay on the inside, it seems to work.
Labonte's Oldsmobile in first. Chevrolet is in second. And now Marlin is being challenged for third. Up alongside, as those two leaders begin to pull away, comes Bodine, and right behind them is Rick Wilson, who ran his first race here back in 1981 and looked good.
Well, Neil, this is one of the worst things that can happen. Those two cars running side by side for third place, the leaders are going to be able to pull away.
Yeah, they're going to be able to get away and get out there, and it's going to be hard that much run down.
But remember, in three laps, they're all coming in. Mandatory yellow flag. Allison. Bobby Allison right up behind his son, Davey, I believe, here. No, that is
that's my little race car.
That's father and son going at it this afternoon.
I'll tell you what, from the looks of some of these cars in the corners, I'm sure those radios have been going saying how many laps. You'll probably see some chassis adjustments if they have a mandatory yellow.
So I need some relief.
That's right.
Davey Allison in the number 12 car. Remember, he finished 12th here a year ago. 10th a year ago in the Haas Ellington car. Beautiful shot of turn number two in the mountains surrounding Talladega, Alabama. A warm day. Temperature already up into the mid-90s. Here's Labonte in the lead. Earnhardt in second. They're trying to draw away. NASCAR tells us that within about three laps, we're going to see a mandatory caution flag to check on tires. Chipping is what they're calling it, Neil.
Well, what it is, we use such a hard tire at this particular racetrack. The tire doesn't go away. It's actually so hard that it just grains a section of rubber out of there. The tire, there's no problem as far as it blowing out, but it's just chipping away, and they want to see how bad. After they run several pit stops, they'll get some rubber on the track, and it won't be a problem. It's just going to be require a little bit of running on track to get it ready to go.
I'm sure it makes Goodyear very nervous to have people making a gigantic pit stop for rubber, but it's really not the tire here. And some people know how to set up a tire a whole lot better than others, right, man?
Oh, yes. Depending on how the chassis is set up, how the driver takes the car into the turn, the amount of pressure that is put, particularly on that right front wheel, that's the one that makes the biggest beating going into a turn.
If you set a field of 30 on any racetrack, there'll be at least eight that'll never get the tire combination right, and they'll grind up tires all day, no matter what.
Yeah. And they'll make adjustments during the race, which will help to rectify those problems. But you're right, there is a varied amount of settings under this car.
A lot of time you hear guys say, boy, I had a bad right front, I had a bad right rear. In this particular group of cars, you're going to have some of them with bad front tires, some with bad rears. They just have one end of their race car not working.
Well, there you see the two leaders now being overhauled. And I'll tell you, they are getting overhauled. Sterling Marlin and Rick Wilson are back in it, and Buddy Baker, take a look at this. Baker with his Oldsmobile, he's clambering back up in the field. There's Baker in a pack of traffic as he goes down into the corner. Bodine has dropped back in there with him, and Tim Richmond. I believe that's Bobby Hillen in there as well.
Well, Baker started in the 12th position and has moved up to 8th, had an awfully good run at Daytona on July 4th, almost won the race, got caught up in an accident. One driver who you normally see running up there in the pack, Ken Squier, is Darrell Waltrip, the current champion of this division. He's fallen back now to 27th place.
Front four going down into turn number one, and everybody watching the action as two relative unknowns, Sterling Marlin in the number one car, and Rick Wilson from Florida, close on two of the giants of the game. Just incredible watching these people battle, and that really isn't as tight as they'll get. Regular race fan will tell you when it gets down to showtime here today, they'll be right on each other's bumpers. You actually feel contact out there, Neil?
Well, it depends who you're racing with. Sometimes there's contact. At this racetrack, you have to push them down that straightaway. And a lot of times the driver will tell you to do that. He'll want you to get up and lean on him and give him that little bit of push down through there. A little yellow blue car there, he likes it.
Bobby Allison is developing a crack in his windshield. Ooh, that's bad news for Allison. Bobby here in May, and the Stavola brothers have really put together a great car for him for this event. Already you can see the telltale signs of a hard day for Bobby Allison following his son Davey. I talked to Bobby after his son Davey knocked him out of qualifying. They qualified 20 cars the first day. Allison was 20th. The last car on the track was that number 12, the Neil Bonnett car, with Davey Allison in it. He cracked the seventh fastest time, knocked his father right out of qualifying. And I mentioned yesterday that afterwards, he said, I got to tell you, his mother was smiling and his grandfather was smiling and I was smiling too.
I guarantee he's smiling right now. Look at the back of him. He's doing a good job. Again, you look at that crack. Driving these cars, you have to learn how to read something like that. That particular thing right there is not going to bother Bobby. That crack has been up. It's already went back down and ran out of the windshield. What concerns you is when they started heading to the top and go all the way across. I believe that particular crack there has done all the damage.
Neil Bonnett with us today. Ed Jarrett, Ken Squier, trackside. Down to the pits, Chris Economaki and Mike Joy. The battle continuing up in front. Terry Labonte is running in first, and Earnhardt is in second. We'll continue with more live action from the Talladega 500 after this word from your local station.
I'd say the NFL today is...
Right, Irv. It's solid reporting. Current topical interview.
No. It's a special inside story. That gut feeling when the team's going to turn it around.
Well, actually...
It's facts.
It's instinct.
What I mean
picking
is
the right story and following it through.
It's football with the heart.
With the brains and the experience.
The NFL today is teamwork.
That's what it's all about.
This is CBS.
Potapkin announces no monthly payments until 1987. No monthly payments till 1987. Choose any brand new 86 Cadillac or Mitsubishi in stock. Drive out today with no money down and don't make a payment until 1987. No payments in July or August, September, October, November, or December. No payments for 6 months. Potapkin has over 1,000 cars for immediate delivery. Potapkin has never made an offer like this before. We'll make your first six payments. You don't pay till 1987 at Potapkin Cadillac and Mitsubishi.
So this is the Ultimate.
In person.
Not you, Larry. New Amacore Ultimate.
Since when do you know gasoline?
I don't. My car knows.
New Amaco Ultimate Premium. The engine cleaning gasoline for pure power and performance. Your car knows.
You know, Bird, you and the Ultimate have nothing in common.
Nothing but magic, Johnson.
Cute, Bird.
New Amaco Ultimate. Your car knows.
An exclusive interview with Stevie Wonder, Monday.
The mandatory caution period has been on the track. And I would say things are hunky-dory on those cars. We saw Harry Gant dive in and just take a momentary stop on pit road. Just a glance from crew chief Travis Carter, and he bounded right back into the action.
And he might be the leader when this thing's restarted, Ken. As a result, he was quick to come into the pits. He didn't wait until he came around to take the caution himself. The caution was on the track. He was far back in the field. He dived in, got some gasoline. They looked at the tire, sent him on his way.
However, as we mentioned earlier, you can see some others where that is not the story. They're fixing the windshield on Allison's car, taking the opportunity here to put in a new windshield. I guess that's a record on windshield changes.
I tell you what, they did it before when he won the race, and they did it in just like 30-something seconds. It doesn't take long.
You mean it doesn't take a full day?
Well, it seems like he's out of there. It looks like they change it quick and then clean it.
21 laps are now complete here in the $516,000 Talladega 500, 18th annual. We've gone through a mandatory caution period, and there is a second echelon of cars now pulling onto pit road. A lot of activity down there. Here's Mike Joy.
Dave Marcus, the last lap, parked his car behind the pit wall. The car he wanted to drive today was wrecked in practice, so he started a backup. But he has a second team car that Iowan Phil Barkdahl is just climbing out of now. Marcus will hop into this Ford automobile. He climbed out of a Chevrolet. And now Barkdahl is going to be sent to run around behind the pit wall and get in the other car. Marcus feels with the Ford he has a better chance to stay in contention and win. But will either of them know which pit to stop in next? Let's go to Chris.
Okay, I'm up at Phil Elliott's pit. He made his stop, took on four tires, was in the pits a very long time, but surprisingly enough, no chassis changes were made. We turned around, Dale Walters pit is right next to this one. He's way back. He took four tires, and there no chassis changes were made. Perhaps Neil Bonnett can comment on that. I figured in both cases, we'd see some adjustments. Back to you, Ken.
Well, I tell you what, on a deal like that with Bill, I don't know that he didn't back off the pace there and just let him run. He knew there was fixing to be a caution flag and a restart of this race. You might see him go after him now.
Harry Gant has just come back into the pits. Not again. You saw Phil Barkdahl clambering into the 71 out here.
Ken, I'm sure that some fans will wonder, well, why didn't they just switch cars before they started the race rather than go through all of this situation here? Phil Barkdahl is a rookie. He has to start the car that he qualifies in. So he had to, that was mandatory, that he start the number 73. And as Mike Joy pointed out, the 73 is a better car than the backup car. Marcus, of course, is the experienced driver, former winner here, so they want him in the best car.
Let's see if we can get a word with Harry Gant. Harry, do you hear us? Harry Gant? Ken Squier at CBS Control. Harry, do you read us?
Yeah, Ken, I'll read you loud and clear.
How are your tires?
I haven't got a report back yet, Ken. I don't really know.
How's the race running for you? Talladega hasn't been particularly kind to car 33.
No, it hasn't. We got a long day today. You know, we only got behind here. The car's awful loose, and it's bottoming out in the corners real bad. It's cutting the tires, and we don't want to run them down so thin that they'll blow out, so we're trying to get the car raced up off the tires.
One lap, and you're going back to racing. Thank you very much, Harry Gant.
Ken, that's brought up there about the handling. This racetrack used to be a deal. You come up here and anybody handled on it with a new surface. I was talking to Bobby and some of the guys in the garage. I know when I ran here last, the track is getting to be a handling racetrack again. When it gets up the temperature we're dealing with, these tires get up 240, 260 degrees. You've got to have a good chassis under the car. And I think that's why you saw the first race, a bunch of guys run to the front, and then it kind of weeded out. You saw Labonte come up through there. A good handling race car is going to be tough today.
Thank you, Neil. Item, car 44. Labonte ignored the yellow, didn't slow down, and car 44 will be at the rear of the field. We'll try to isolate him for you. Again, 44, Labonte didn't slow down for the caution, and he's out back when they restart this.
That makes it awfully tough, but it also, Neil, makes you more determined, too. It makes you a little bit mad and say, well, by golly, if they're going to put me back here, I'll show them.
Especially when you got a car that was doing what Terry's was doing, leading that race. He'll try to do it for him now.
For the first time since 1974, the Talladega 500 has been brought under caution by NASCAR officials. Back in 74, they found the garage area, remember, prior to the race. Here's Chris Economaki.
Okay, here are the tires that have come off of Darrell Waltrip's car. The temperature readings were 230 degrees on the right front and 210 on the right rear, but everything seems to be okay. Those are normal temperatures.
So the drivers and the members of the crew say there's no problem with the tires, so the precautionary stop was just precautionary. No changes necessary. Now, down pit road to Mike Joy.
Well, here are the tires that came off Harry Kent's car, and this is the chipping effect that the drivers are talking. I can't even touch this tire, it's so hot. But it's just little grooves that are being worn around the circumference of the tire. And as opposed to chunking, you talk about on top of the block, this where whole sections of rubber would come out. This does not appear to be a serious problem, but it's good for everybody to get it checked out on this pit stop. It's kind of like going into the shoe store. You can try on two pair of size 9s. One pair will fit you a little better, the other pair won't, even though they both came off the same machine and they're made from the same materials. One pair will break in and be fine, but another pair, it just won't work on your feet. That's the problem with race car tires. They'll work fine on one chassis setup. They won't work quite so well on another. That's what's happening up and down pit road here today.
That's the story from Mike Joy, checking in the tires that came off the Harry Hyde car, Tim Richmond's machine. There's Labonte on the move. We're back underway. The race resumed on the 24th lap. First 20 laps, we're running an average speed of 200 miles per hour. Watch Labonte in that 44. Up in front, Earnhardt is leading, but Labonte is just charging his heart out here, trying to move around through the field and get back up and work with the leaders. We saw him challenging for the lead in the early going. I think that's Chet Phillips' car directly in front of him now. 44, Labonte just wheeling through cars.
As long as he can stay on the outside of the racetrack and those turns nail and pass him like that, that gives him a lot of momentum coming off the turn.
It does. If he has to pinch that car down in some traffic, it really takes it away. He can work the top of the track as good as his car is running. He can get up a good head of steam.
Back with the leaders. And the leader coming by this time. Out in front, Sterling Marlin. I think that many of the young drivers are making an extra effort here today, knowing that this begins the crazy season. A lot of talk about where superstars are going next year, forming new teams, Cale Yarborough, Darrell Waltrip, and there are some chairs and some very good ones available for some new talent.
And what they call the silly season is starting much earlier this year than before, after it leaked out that Darrell Waltrip would be leaving the Johnson ride. Waddell Wilson will be leaving as crew chief on Cale Yarborough's car. So that has opened up a lot of things that will be happening here in the last half of the season, and it has started a lot earlier than in years prior.
Now, Benny Parsons, who has not won this race, here he comes over that fourth turn bobble and picks that car up to challenge Sterling Marlin, with Earnhardt resting in the third position. Richard Petty has moved up into eight, going fourth right now is Bodine. Fifth is Rick Wilson. Wilson really hanging in there. Has new sponsorship, and that team has really come together.
It has. Morgan McClure out of Abingdon, Virginia, a little town over in the mountains, Coal Mountain section of Virginia. Good race fans, Tim Morgan and Larry McClure.
Now here comes Labonte, and he's tightening up the screws on the Ricky Rudd car. He's also pulling up on the number 11 now of Waltrip, going up on the high side of Waltrip. Car 44 going through the field. Labonte picking him up.
And Dave Marcus has picked him up. He was in the rear, too, as a result of changing, getting in that car. And he picked Labonte up and just stayed right with him. Here comes Benny Parsons for the lead.
Parsons sticks the nose of his car out in front. The number 55 jumps out in front as those two cars run side by side in second and slow up a bit. And Parsons draws away, gets a 20, 25 car length advantage. Largest we've seen anyone enjoy this afternoon.
Talladega, that's like leading by a freight train right there. That's a big lead at this place. But the minute they line up, Benny will have his rear window full of cars again.
Bobby Hillen is back in 10th. Bill Elliott is 9th in the number 9. Richard Petty is in 8th in the 43. Then comes Cale Yarborough in the 7th and Tim Richmond in 6th. From the front of the field, you see Sterling Marlin in that second position. Bodine coming into 3rd. Rick Wilson in the number 4 is into 4th. And now Cale Yarborough up on the outside is to 5th. And along comes Richard Petty for 6th. Petty having a marvelous day.
Well, Yarborough won this race a year ago, had a disappointing qualifying run here, Ken. He had an ignition problem, qualified way back to about 19th position, but he said that the car was working well in the practice after the qualifying, and he said, I'll be a factor in this race, and it looks like he's going to be.
30 laps are now complete. Watching the battle for second place here, Sterling Marlin, Jeff Bodine. And slipping along up the inside.
And Ken just making an unscheduled pit stop with Buddy Baker, who had moved up into fifth place. He's going to fight to try to stay in the lead lap as the leaders come around. He won't get his feet up. He'll go a lap down, I believe.
Baker's going a lap down. We have one car. 17 in trouble. 17 lands on the bottom of the racetrack and is in trouble. Pancho Carter out of Indiana. The Roger Hamby car, winner of the 81 Michigan 500, and they're racing back to the line.
And Baker's really fighting right now to get that lap back. He was able to get up in front of him and kind of cut him off at the pass, and now it looks like he's going to be able to beat him back around.
A good break for Buddy Baker, who had just made an unscheduled pit stop for a tire change. Apparently had a tire leaking down, so this will be a break for him as he's going to lead lap.
Real break for Buddy Baker in his Oldsmobile. Pancho Carter, best finish this year for car 17, 17th at Michigan. Wild slide brings out the second caution of the day, the first one mandatory.
As racing goes in this sport, Baker got that lap back. He went turn and hit the oil off Pancho's car about 8 inches. But he did miss the wall, so it almost went from fate to famine in a hurry on him.
Leaders are all pitting. Everyone pulling back onto pit road. 17 just sitting there. We have a replay of it. Ned, how about this one?
It looks like it, evidently the engine let go. We see a lot of smoke coming from it. It started to go around to the right. He corrected it, sent it up the other way, and it just got away from him in the back end, and around he goes. Of course, he's waiting for the thing to hit the wall somewhere, but fortunately, it's staying up in the center of the track, and
that's what you call
it. Avoid the wall.
That's what you call an excellent job of driving with your eyes closed right
now,
there.
Now, that's what we say as announcers all the time, Neil. But as you say with your eyes closed.
When I do one of those, I get out and I tell them what a heck of a job I did. But if they had a camera in car, they could see exactly what's going on. You crank that thing left and hang on.
Let's go to Chris.
Walter was just pulling out. He took on four tires, and yet only 10 laps ago, he took on four tires. The question Neil Bonnett might answer is why, after only 10 laps of usage, are the tires all changed again? Thanks.
Chris, I think what we're looking at combination. We saw Gant do the same thing, and he told us before that he was loose, and he was one of the cars we saw chipping tires. Darrell's not content with that race car right now, and if they're come in repeatedly and try to readjust that chassis, change the stagger, and work with their car. Luckily enough, they've got an opportunity to do that. I think you'll see most of the guys keep time and time again working on that chassis.
And they might put some of these same tires back on a little bit later in the race.
I noticed, Ned, earlier in the week, the guys usually bring old tires down to practice on. They were going through their old tires wanting to use them in the race because they ran maybe the last race here two or three months ago. They're harder. They've cured. So that tire's got a better chance of withstanding this. We'll probably burn them up today, put 240-degree temperature in them, cool them down, and bring them back later, just like you said.
Average speed through the first 30 laps was 174.426. We had experienced one caution, and now we are in the second. And that one was brought about by the spin of number 17. He was blessed, no one near him, as he looped it right in the middle of the 33-degree banking.
Well, we got the tire thing on mind here, Ned. And again, I saw it happen this week, and we've done it ourselves in places like this. We'll get maybe Buddy Arrington or somebody back. We'll give them a brand new set of tires to run a pit stop on. Let them run a new set of tires for us the next time we take them back and run them ourselves. We'll let them actually scuff a set of tires one pit stop, so we'll have them ourselves.
Which is a real break for them because they don't get an opportunity many times to get new tires on their cars.
That's right. That $640 set of tires, they ride a free lap on them. It helps us also.
You have to pay for that kind of service.
Well, if you win the race, you're pretty generous.
We'll be back with more of the 1986 Talladega 500 on CBS after these messages.
Now get 6.9 financing or $300 cash back direct from Ford.
Out here, a thunderstorm rolls in fast. Sometimes too fast. And when they're taken care of, it's your turn. Push. Head for the beer brewed natural as a mountain stream, for a taste as smooth as its name. Bush.
Head for Bush beer.
Head for the mountain.
You know what? Make you Mr. Wrong. Get the right spray.
I had enough of Mr. Wrong. I wanna be with Mr. Right. Mr. Right.
For all those performance cars that want to keep performing even in wet, sloppy weather, Goodyear introduces the Eagle GT Plus 4. High performance and all-weather performance in one remarkable tire. The Eagle GT Plus 4. The performance won't be canceled by the weather. You either have Goodyear Eagles or you need them.
On the lightning-fast screens of Warwick Hills, there's little room for error. Live coverage of the Buick Open on CBS Sports next.
Following the Talladega 500, CBS will have live final round coverage of the Buick Open. There you see how it's going. Crenshaw, Pertzer, Love, Pate, all 14 under. Sowers is 13 under. Kenny Knox, 12 under. And nine players are tied at 11. 18 players are within four shots of the lead, Ned. That's your kind of golf.
Oh, boy, I wish I could play like that. They really have a battle going on there.
The Buick Open coming up on CBS following our Talladega 500. Ben Crenshaw is trying for his first win since his Masters victory back in 1984.
That's like the competition we have here. They're about as close.
Indeed. See if it'll sugar off the same way as we anticipate this one this afternoon. Here's the field working through the 34th lap as they come by.
And look who's up front. Jimmy Means.
Jimmy Means from Alabama.
Dave Marcus was up front. He went into the pits. Now,
I think that was
come all the way from the rear.
They had that as Phil Barkdahl. We're gonna play frickin' track with that one all afternoon with the Barkdahl Marcus swap around out here.
But anyway, Jimmy Means, he doesn't get an opportunity to lead many races. He's formerly from Huntsville, Alabama, not too far from here. Moved to Forest City, North Carolina about 7-8-10 years ago to be closer to the center of racing, so the parts availability and all that kind of thing, and has struggled. Never had major sponsorship, but he's always there at every race running and doing his best.
Ned, I tell you what, to give you an indication of where this sport is, Jimmy right now runs in the middle and has to work hard to run up the front of the track pack. But when he ran Birmingham, Alabama, he used to thrash me and Bobby and Donnie Allison pretty regular on that track. He's a winning race car driver. He just doesn't have quite the kind of equipment he needs.
Last time he led was in Richmond, Virginia. Got to send him a photograph of that leaderboard. Jimmy Means running in first of Richard Petty, Dale Earnhardt, Davey Allison, and Jeff Bodine. Here's Mike Joy.
This shock absorber just was taken off Harry Gant's car on this last pit stop off the left front of the automobile. It doesn't leave him without one, though. Harry's car was handling loose, and they thought if they reduced the damping on the left front corner of the car by removing one of the two shock absorbers there, it would increase the bite back on the right rear. So Gant now has three shocks on the front of the car, one on the left front and the standard two normal shock absorbers on the right front. Ken?
Thank you. Harry Gant inside of his automobile now. Running outside of the top, back up in there. Bobby Allison with another in-car camera is moving up into the eighth position. I believe we're one lap away from a restart. Back on this restart, Sterling Marlin, who we've seen run so well, will find himself back in 20th. Richmond will be relegated to 23rd. Elliott will start from 24th.
So, and there's Jimmy Means, the leader on pit road. So that means we're going to have some hot dogs that are going to be coming up through the field.
And we're going to have Richard Petty leading as we get this race back underway. Number 43, Richard Petty, back in front. Former winner of the Talladega 500. Means coming along. Here's Davey Allison's number 12 coming back out again. He's running in the third position as we get set on this restart. How do you think he's doing?
He's doing good, Ken. You know, that car right there is one of the narrowest race cars on the track. It's a 55 and a half inch wide race car, which means it's awful hard to drive. We built that car for ultimate speed. And we talked to Davey about, you know, getting the car tight and all. And it's probably going to take him a while to get used to it. It seems like he's really got the handle on it.
If the car is narrower, does it also make it warmer?
Yeah, everything's packed in that thing awful tight. You know, that particular car spent extensive time in the wind tunnel. There's no air inside the car at all.
Let's go to Chris.
Okay, I'm down here with Tim Brewer. Tim, you got yourself a young newcomer behind the wheel at number 12, Davey Allison. How's he doing?
He's doing pretty well here, Chris. He's pretty familiar with the racetrack. He's won several races here. He's doing a good job for us right now.
You happy with his drive?
Yes, right now we're real happy with the kid.
What's he asking you on the radio?
Not much. He's a pretty quiet kid. He don't have a lot to say.
Okay, Tim Brewer, cool and calm on a hot day at Talladega.
Just like Neil Bonnett.
Is that the way I do? Sometimes I get excited.
You use that radio a lot.
Yeah, but sometimes it's not exactly the one everybody wants to hear what you're saying on it either.
I understood you chattered a whole lot.
Yeah, we kind of make adjustments in a hurry when we're out there.
All right, ready on a restart. Coming around to complete 36 laps, and we'll go back to green after the second caution of the 18th annual $500,000 Talladega 500 live flag-to-flag coverage here on CBS. Richard Petty, the all-time champion, seven-time winner of Daytona, the seven-time national champion, brings those familiar colors of number 43 online with Dale Earnhardt, a former national champion himself, ready to challenge from second position. Young Davey Allison trying to write his own ticket on up into the heights of motorsport by challenging those two this afternoon. On the break, Earnhardt to the inside. Earnhardt winds it up, goes down low. Petty stays with him. They run side by side. We can have them five deep going into number three. As they break for the corner, screw that brother A.J. Boyd, a lap down, is trying to get himself back up in there. There's A.J. The two leaders wheel to wheel in turn number three. Petty on the outside, Earnhardt on the inside. Allison drops down a groove. He looks to the inside as they come off that 33-degree banking. Here they come three wide and also mixing it up. Davey Allison for the lead. Davey Allison, bottom three wide. Look at this. Joe Rutland is right in the midst of it as well. The green and white car, the Kenny Bernstein car, is in that hunt. Back to two abreast in turn number one. That's great racing.
It is great racing, Ken, and you see them running side by side as close as they're running together. Look how close Earnhardt came to Richard Petty as he came off the turn, but he knew where he was.
Bobby Allison challenging his son as he goes. Petty is there. You're following the battle for first place from inside Allison's car. He's on the low side as they wheel down through three and four, almost touching.
And it looks like Terry Labonte went awfully high. Apparently something wrong. He did get back down through the traffic. Now brings it down on the pit road. A lot of smoke coming from the car, perhaps an injury.
That is the luckiest moment of the race. He was in heavy traffic, and he could have collected about eight cars at 200 miles per hour. Labonte gets his car in, locks up the brakes, and brings it to a halt. Meanwhile, up in front, it is still wheel to wheel, inches apart for the lead. Back inside of Bobby Allison's car, battling up front. Earnhardt on the inside, Petty on the outside. Davey Allison in third, the green and white car. Rutman is fourth. Then in fifth is Bobby Allison. Not much room for a mistake here.
I tell you what, Ken, at a place like this, you get so used to seeing this, after three and four abreast, you say, oh, heck, they're just two abreast. This is the only place in the world you'll see it.
Jeff Bodine pulls up alongside Allison again in his attack. Incredible racing. It's live here on CBS. Now Phil Parsons pulls up on Bobby Allison. It's Phil Parsons at number 66 trying to work his way up alongside number 22.
Parsons has a strong car here today. He had come from way back in the field and had gotten up in the top 10, and now they're battling for the lead.
And he goes all the way to the bottom. That's Parsons way down low.
And his brother Benny even trying to go lower.
Father passing son here. What a struggle. Bobby Allison low. Davey Allison right there looking over at his dad at 200 miles an hour.
He sat there and watched him running in that traffic in and said, maybe I better get up there and show Davey a little bit more about how you do it.
I don't think Davey wanted to help. Here's Earnhardt taking his own line, really low now, making that Richard Childress car go low, and caution is out. Third caution of the day is on the track. Oil is reported on the track.
Perhaps from the Labonte car.
Well, they ran a lap or two through it, and that tremendous dodging battle up in front. Earnhardt staying in first, Petty in second. Phil Parsons with a magnum. Remember, Parsons had that terrible flip, rolling over 12 times in turn number one. Doesn't seem to bother him a bit. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Well, you're looking at the left front tire of Terry Labonte's.
Right. Is that for sure, Ned?
I don't think it's for sure. There's a lot of speculation that he'll get the Junior Johnson ride next year, but you never know. There's a lot of things going on this time of year. A lot of speculation, and that's what it is. But that's the way the talks are going.
You have anything to add to that? You're part of that team.
I tell you what. All I know is Junior's going to have a new driver next year in his car, and I'm sure they'll win a lot of races. Junior keeps that car in front all the time. I don't know who it'll be right now.
So we're back under caution for the third time in the Talladega 500. Following these messages.
He lives in jeans.
You got the money, honey. I've got the time.
Gotta be comfortable.
And we'll have a time.
Gotta last.
We'll have more fun, baby.
Gotta be Wrangler.
If you got the money, honey, I've got the time.
Legend in jeans. Wrangler.
Night training. It never Goodwrench. Cars change. He changes. He picks from over 100 General Motors service schools to stay on the leading edge of service technology. He keeps up with fuel injection, turbocharger changes, new electronics, transaxle advances, you name it. He's trained to be good. He's trained to stay good. Mr. Goodwrench, no one knows your GM car better. No one.
I bet you think my favorite bubbly is champagne. Well, surprise. What I really love is Sun Country Wine Cooler. It's a truly marvelous blend of real fruit juice and premium wine. As a matter of fact, it's the best tasting cooler I've ever had. So when they asked me to talk about Sun Country, naturally, I accepted. Sun Country. Say, give me the real juice cooler. They told me I'd be working in fur, but this is ridiculous.
That's fun.
Yeah, but that sure gives me an appetite, Loretta.
Well, come on. I bet my Crisco cooking will fix that up.
Fried chicken, my favorite.
Well, dig in. Crisco's what makes it so golden brown and delicious. Because it fries up chicken crisp as the country morning.
Real crunchy.
And no greasy taste, either.
And Crisco has no cholesterol. How come no one thanks him?
Because we're all too busy eating.
Crisco will do you proud every time.
Sit down, AJ.
Where?
Tuesday, sit in with Simon and Simon.
I want you to tell me every little detail.
Professionals, they have the respect of those around them. Simon and Simon.
We're back with you live once again at Talladega, Alabama, with Neil Bonnett alongside on the mend after a terrible crash at Pocono, Pennsylvania just last Sunday, and Ned Jarrett topside, Chris Economaki, Mike Joy in the pits. I'm Ken Squier. There are the standings. Dale Earnhardt has the lead. Phil Parsons in the second position. Joe Ruttman is getting back into winning form, maintaining third. Rick Wilson finds himself in fourth, and Jeff Bodine in fifth. Terry Labonte has brought out the caution. He is the second man to retire, the first being Poncho Carter, who spun earlier. Labonte hasn't finished the top five since Martinsville back in April. And it was not to be today. Back on pit road, find out what Dale Inman's thinking about this race.
Well, we're here with Dale Inman, Richard Petty's crew chief. Richard looks to be pretty good today, Dale. What's he saying and how's he feeling?
Well, he says he's right busy out there, and he hadn't complained about the heat, but I hadn't asked him about it, so I don't want to get him thinking about it. But we just stopped in. It's got us a little ways behind right here, but the car's doing decent, and we worked pretty hard on it down here, and Rich seems to be doing a pretty good job, Chris. I just hope we can stay out of trouble and have a pretty good day.
Seems to be up for today, though.
Well, I think Richard gets up every day. He's it might not show it sometime, but Richard's run hurt a lot this year, and He when the car will do it, he'll do it.
Okay, thanks very much, Jim. Let's go down pit road now to Mike Joy.
I'm with coroner Richard Childress. Dale Earnhardt is his driver, who won this race in 83 for Bud Moore and 84 for you. How's he saying about track conditions and about his race car?
Well, he says it was a little greasy to start with, but the track started coming in after that last set of tires was put on. So I believe everything's going to be okay.
How are you doing on tire wear?
Looked real good a while ago. You always get a little more at Talladega on the first stop, but after it starts getting a little greasy, you pick up better tire wear.
Oftentimes this race has been won or lost on fuel mileage. Any idea yet what you're going to be able to run on a tank of fuel?
You'll see cars running from 34 to 36, 37
Marcus
laps.
Right in there.
And you? We should be in between there somewhere.
That's Richard Childress. Back to Ken Squier.
Let's review for the moment how things are going in the overall here. We have Dale Earnhardt leading, Phil Parsons in second, Joe Ruttman in third, Rick Wilson in fourth, Morgan Shepherd is in fifth, Jeff Bodine is in sixth, Bobby Hill in seventh, Sterling Marlin eighth, Rusty Wallace ninth, Cale Yarborough tenth, Ron Bouchard is in 11th, Tommy Ellis is in 12th. Maintaining 13th is Ken Reagan, 14th is Dave Marcus, 15th Jim Sauter, 16th Tim Richmond, and back in 17th is Darrell Waltrip. We have a total of 44 laps complete when the field comes by this time.
And of course, still on the lead lap, Ken, are such drivers as Benny Parsons, Davey Allison, who made pit stop during this caution period, and Buddy Baker, Ricky Rudd, A.J. Foyt, of course, lost a lap earlier in the race, but still a lot of cars running for the lead.
When we saw the drivers being introduced today, we saw more cool suits than we've ever seen before.
I think there was something like close to half of the field that is wearing cool suits today.
Yeah, and what's interesting about that is it's by the guys that are supposed to be the toughest guys on the circuit. In the past, when they first introduced these things, they said, well, I'm not going to wear one. No sissy wears a cool suit. But Earnhardt, Cale Yarborough, these guys started putting them on. You saw everybody break them out and start wearing them. It's foolish not to take advantage of something like that that will get you in a better frame of mind and let you function in that car better.
The latest in sartorial splendor, the cool suit, and it may save a lot of drivers here today from this 130-degree heat in the cockpit of these cars as they once again go under the green flag. After they've shorted it out for the caution period, going down into turn number one, Earnhardt with the advantage, and Phil Parsons piggybacking as they go into turn number two.
Boy, they really broke away on that restart.
Back there in third, I think is the A.J. Foyt car still a lap down.
That is correct.
There's number 14, Foyt, a lap down. Joe Ruttman is in third in the green and white car, number 26. Behind him, Rick Wilson, still very much a factor in the early going.
Earnhardt is a master on restarts. He really accelerates. I don't know if it's a combination of his reaction time and or the transmission that he has in it, the gearing that he has a lot to do on restarts. But Phil Parsons was right on top of it when he restarted it.
Bobby Allison moving around white Mike Waltrip here. He's outside the top 20, trying to close back up. And now he's up on Waltrip. Closing on Waltrip, who has fallen back. That's about the 20th position in the sort out after the restart. We had Waltrip reported in 17. Maybe that Mike Waltrip car had come up a couple of spots. Then you saw Allison overtake first Mike Waltrip and go after his elder brother Darrell.
Well, now A.J. Foyt has closed that distance and drafted right back up to the leaders. He'd like to pass him and get himself back in the lead lap.
Buddy Baker got lucky a while ago. Let's see what happens with A.J. The only man to ever win this race back-to-back, 2 years running, is now leading it. Earnhardt, a man who looks like he may be on his way to the national title. And you want to knock on wood when you say that.
There goes A.J. on the outside. You know, it's good to see him in his frame of mind. He's ready to go racing. He wants that lap back.
A.J. high, way up on the top of Phil Parsons. Out of two now. Back straightaway, number three, Earnhardt in front. Here's A.J. getting caught beside Parsons. And the train is on the inside.
You know, Ken, it's interesting. Those two young drivers, Phil Parsons and Rick Wilson in particular, are very good friends of A.J. Foyt. Young drivers on the circuit, and, you know, it's somewhat of a mismatch, if you'd think, but they are very close. And Rick Wilson and A.J. are very, very close.
He's helped both of these guys in their racing careers.
Sure has.
There's been a real affinity between A.J. and Rick Wilson. They've garaged together at every stock car race possible. Rick Wilson's a young contractor down in Florida.
I tell you what, that's the only thing about this sport. The way you repay your friends is you show on the back end of your race car.
Well, Phil Parsons is able to do it there right now, and Rick Wilson running right on the back bumper of A.J. Now he's going to move down on the inside and say, well, A.J., you taught me pretty well. Let's see if I can pull it through.
He might have to move over one garage stall after this one.
Number three stays in front, Earnhardt. There's Phil Parsons in second. I'll never forget Parsons after that terrible crash he had in that first turn area. Went over 12 times. Doesn't that make you consider retirement? I'm not going to let a little accident like that bother me any. Some little accident. Here's Mike Joy.
for Marcia Parsons, who's scoring for her husband, Phil, who is well up in the running order at this point. A couple years ago, Phil took one of the worst crashes ever at this speedway. What did you think of when you saw that car going end over end down in turn one?
Well, actually, I didn't really see it, but I just have what you call women's intuition, and I knew it was him. And I just started screaming, and I ran down to the pits, and Phil's crew chief, Richard Jackson, told me, he said, I think you better go to the hospital. And I went, and I was, it was like it wasn't even real. I mean, it was like it wasn't even Phil in the car, and that wasn't him laying in the hospital and stuff, and it was just, it was a very scary experience.
But Phil, of course, recovered to run really well here today. That car flipped seven times and landed on top of Ricky Rudd's roof and trunk lid, so that Rudd, who didn't know what had happened, radioed to his pit that he thought a plane from the nearby Talladega Airport had landed on his roof. The car, which now resembles something that came out of a crusher, sits in a reserve spot in the Hall of Fame Museum adjacent to the speedway.
The top three, Rick Wilson is closing up, really making a run here at the two leaders, and Joe Ruttman seems to be developing a problem further back in the field. We understand a hood pin may be loose on Ruttman's car. Challenge for the lead. Look at Parsons going in. There's Ruttman's car, the number 26.
And it looked like you can see the left front of the hood coming up, and boy, the pressure that you have here with air going under there, it won't take long to do some damage, Neil.
Yeah, and what's really critical, the particular brand of car, that Buick, the entire top of that car is the hood. The top of the fenders is the hood section. So he doesn't even have a fender left if that hood comes up.
Down they go into turn number one. Challenge on. Parsons is taking one more swipe to get back underneath Dale Earnhardt. And Rick Wilson stays right with him. It's a great struggle for first place. And another new name, Phil Parsons, as far as challenging for the lead, is up there making some headway. You could saw him just for a moment, bobble a moment, pick it up out of turn number two.
I tell you what, these boys are learning how to drive these race cars. You talk about that crash end over end, that never enters into these guys' mind. All they're wanting to do is get up there and run up front and get their name built up in this sport and be winners. And you have to just learn what to do with that race car when it gets away from you, and they're driving them.
Bobby Allison in traffic, moving up on Ricky Rudd here. Last report was in 20th. He's bettered his mark now. That looks to me like perhaps 18th. We'll check it this time by.
Go.
Trouble. Richard Petty is loose. He is sliding all the way down to the tri-oval. He's almost tagging the wall. He's crashed into the wall, and now he's spinning again and coming to rest down here in turn number one.
Fortunately, the car did not shoot back out on the racetrack, Ken, as far, because that would have been devastating as they went into the first turn if he had slid back out off the grass.
Yeah, and it was a glancing blow, you know, certainly out of the race, but it looked like maybe nothing that would have hurt Richard.
Richard Petty's automobile coming to the tri-oval got loose, and before it came to the exit of pit road, it was sideways, and then it began a series of long spins through the grass, and he has tapped the wall, the first concrete wall, then gone across an entry road onto the track another 300 feet and come to a halt.
And the safety crew is there to help him. He's been trying to get his safety window net loose. It's hard to loosen that thing from the inside, Neil, so he almost needs help from the outside.
Sure is. We get them really tight for this particular track so the wind doesn't blow them out.
Let's take a look at a replay from inside Harry Gant's car and what happened. That's Petty up about two cars from Harry Gant.
And he was in heavy traffic, apparently, just getting loose in the heavy traffic. And around she goes. Boy, that was a long, wild slide. And you can see that Gant doesn't have much vision there for a moment. Here it is from another angle. Petty on the high side of the racetrack.
Ooh.
Well, he was fortunate, and so was everyone else fortunate.
How does he get through there?
Almost clipping the...
I tell you what, I'm not so sure we didn't have some liquid
coming
out of the front of
that car.
That's the
88 of Baker that he almost took. Well, I want to see that again. I can't believe that it's better than 190 miles an hour. There's the contact with the wall, then across this entry road. There's a lot of water right there that's built up.
That's what we saw fly.
Let's look from Bobby Allison's car, Ned.
Everything going along fine. Then all of a sudden, I think Neil's right. I think there was the engine let go in the car.
It happened too quick, yes.
Yeah. And then it got sideways, of course, losing traction when the oil and water got on the rear tires. And Allison, of course, didn't have any vision at this point either.
That was Allison right there on the marker.
Mm-hmm. And Teddy slid right down across the track in front of him and down onto the grass. Unfortunately, he stayed down there.
I think as Bobby went into that cloud, you could kind of see the milk hit the windshield as he went into that. And it just, that's exactly what it looks like in that car. The water and oil makes it just a milky combination.
That was, that Allison picture was absolutely incredible. He was right there. Here's Petty's car being picked up and being brought back. Let's go to Chris.
Okay, I'm at Dale Earnhardt's pit. He is refusing a drink as he comes in for part two of his pit stop work during this particular yellow flag. There's a lot of attention being paid to the right rear corner, not only by the crew people, but by the inspectors. There may be problems over there. It's beyond my field of vision, but they're coming out now, and the car is down, and it looks like it's all been handled okay. And Dale Earnhardt, the hottest driver in the early part of this season, is back on the track.
Let's see if we can raise Harry Gant. Here's Earnhardt coming back out. Harry Gant, Ken Squier at CBS Control. Do you hear us?
Yeah, Ken, I hear you loud and clear.
That was about as close as you want to get, Harry.
Yeah, it was. I thought the car may go, Richard was going to back across the track, you know, real quick. And we was trying to stop as quick as could. That's pretty close.
Did you get in the brakes a lot?
Yeah, I got in all I could because I thought it was better to slow down. And I think everybody behind me saw the signals and no one was really trying to come through fast.
Well, Bobby Allison was blessed. It was almost in front of him, Harry, right there.
Yeah, it looked like it was going to be real bad, but luckily everybody, you know, done okay, and Richard Carr spun to the inside.
Harry, usually the word is you don't want to get on your brakes when something like that happens, but you didn't have any other opportunity, did you?
No, I didn't. I've decided it's best to go ahead and try to slow down even to get hit in the rear than it is to try to beat them and second-guess their direction they're going to go.
Well, good luck to you as you continue on this afternoon.
Harry, is your car working better now that they took that shock absorber off it?
Travis Carter is trying to talk with Harry Gant. Let's take a look again from Allison's car, and Neil Bonnett, ask you about, you know, evasive tactics when a situation like this develops at almost 200 miles an hour in heavy traffic. That's like driving down a city block at 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Just like Bobby's situation, he didn't have a lot of choice. There was a car on the right side of him. There's one directly behind him. He's following Baker there. When he sees Richard coming across, all he can do is make the least bit of move to the right and hope Richard clears out. When that smoke gets there, it's no different than these fans sitting here. You can't tell where that car's at. Luckily enough, when he went through the smoke, he was gone.
One thing you don't want to do is oversteer it. And talking about the braking situation, Ken, as long as you got that car going in a straight direction, it's fine to use those brakes as much as you want to. Where you don't want to lean heavy on the brakes is when you're in a turning position.
That's right. Anytime those wheels are turning, you get on the brakes, that car will dart that way in a hurry. So you have to correct the car, use the brake, and get back off.
Well, the good news is for all of us old Petty fans, he's okay. Car not in such good shape, but Richard is all right. We'll be back with more of the Talladega 500 after these messages.
There's a little bit of copper in every Autolite spark plug. Some have a copper core to help small engines run better. And other Autolite plugs have copper in the seal or gasket for better conductivity. So it doesn't matter if you're driving a small car or a big one, a new car or an old one, an import or a domestic, because Autolite makes a copper plug for every car made. Remember, if Autolite's on it, there's copper in it.
If you're fed up with bite-sized screens that leave you hungry for more, Zenith's new 27-inch stereo TV serves up a feast for the eyes. Zenith. Quality.
Want to see this dull, dry hair disappear? Like magic?
Try some magic.
A touch of VO5 hairdressing's five natural conditioners makes hair easy to manage, healthy looking, and naturally neat. Try some magic. VO5 every day.
This is the car, the number 9 Ford Thunderbird, Bill Elliott's race car. This is Bill Elliott's motor oil, Unocal 76. It's won every Grand National race he's won. It's the same oil you can buy for your car at 76 stations. And this is Bill Elliott.
Ready, boys?
Go with the spirit.
Try Bill's motor oil.
Spirit of 76.
One quick way to put a little fun in your life is this special value Ford Ranger. It comes loaded. Special two-tone paint, special mirrors, chrome rear bumper, tinted glass, luxury interior, interval wipers, AM/FM stereo, power steering, and more. Save $972 on this special value Ford Ranger. The price is a low $75.99. That's over $2,000 less than a Toyota SR5. Now get 6.9 financing or up to $600 cash back direct from Ford, depending on model.
CBS asked me to pick out some of my all-time favorite Magnums, and I told them that was a tough call. So they gave me these.
The Best of Magnum, Tuesdays, all summer long.
55 of 188 laps complete, about to go green. Davey Allison from Hueytown, Alabama, is leading the Talladega 500. His dad, Bobby Allison, in second after a hair-raising experience moment ago. Then Harry Gant is third. Bill Elliott is up to fourth. And Benny Parsons is holding on to the fifth position, getting set on the restart. We hope to get back a little later and take another look in real time from Bobby Allison's car at what happened when Richard Petty had that engine cave in. 31 cars are still on the lead lap. Ned, that's incredible racing.
It really is. We've had 19 lead changes among 14 different drivers here, and we're far from the halfway point.
Dirt track driver Rodney Combs has moved up into eighth position as we get set for restart. Here's the assault. Davey Allison out in front, his dad right with him. That has to be something very meaningful to Bobby Allison to go tearing into the banking of this old Talladega track here in Alabama. The Alabama gang runs one and two, and he pulls up on his young son and guns him down.
That shows you how meaning it is, right there. Meaningful as it can be. I used to ask Bobby, can I borrow your car on Saturday night to go racing? Davey's borrowed this one. He's fixing to make Daddy mad.
All right, here we are, coming down through that banking another time, and we have Bobby Allison out in front. Davey Allison falling back into second. Harry Gant maintaining third. They'll come by to complete 57 laps, and Rodney Combs. Combs is coming up into third position. The car number two, Rodney Combs, there's another newcomer. We keep talking about this race as a race of dark horses, Ned. And once again, look at Combs on the charge.
Bill Parsons, of course, leading, but Combs is a dirt track expert, doesn't have that much experience on asphalt.
Ran some ASA short tracks, competed once before here at Talladega in 1982, finished fourth in the Automobile Racing Club of America, and he's up there in third spot.
Now, Allison has just taken the lead over from Phil Parsons once again, but here comes Combs down on the inside. He wants a shot at the lead.
First start was at Atlanta in 82, where he finished ninth, Winston Cup racing.
Young man has a lot of talent. He's getting an education now.
Yeah.
He used some of that dirt track talent just in through that trial. Well, he had it hung out about 2 foot.
Look at AJ trying to get that lap back, and look at Combs go for the lead. Unbelievable. Bottom of the racetrack. Rodney Combs, a dirt tracker. Not doing much power sliding here. Losing out a little out of turn number two. Combs hangs it in there. AJ pulls up behind Allison.
And that's all Allison needed to pick up the momentum down the backstretch.
This racetrack will introduce you to a lot of new drivers. This thing is so good to race on that you come up here with some good short track experience and you can race with these guys.
My contention is a lot of those youngsters just have a little more courage and they use it here. The veterans, they back off that courage pill just a little, knowing what this track can do to you. Bill Elliott's down on the inside and he's beginning to make a charge. Weeping up through, finds himself now in sixth position. Bill Elliott in car number nine. Meanwhile in front, Allison and a newcomer, Rodney Combs. Go at it.
He's going to try some of that front.
And he has Phil Parsons to help him this time, so he will be able to go to the front, move on by Bobby Allison, just leave him in their wake.
The Robert Harrington prepared car for Robert Combs. Everybody has all these fancy sponsors. Combs is sponsored by Gunk. That's like Rumple Furniture. That's a national company, I believe.
Yes, it is.
Richmond's worked his way up there now. He's been awful tough the last few weeks. He's going to get up there in the front for a while.
And he don't mind mixing it up with him.
That's exactly right.
Tim Richmond, who proved it in Pocono, he doesn't mind mixing it up. comes up into second place. He and Harry Hyde are really the odd couple. Harry Hyde says the only thing we really agree on and talk about in concurrence is racing. Richmond challenging up in front, and look at this battle further back. There's Tim Richmond. Tim Richmond going out in front. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Well, I'm with Richard Petty, and it seems I'm talking to you too early, too often these days.
I know what you mean.
Let the field go past. It's thundering as well as hot here, and now Richard can hear us better. Well, what started to happen over there?
Well, really, going through the dog leg there, the engine went loose, must have broken. Locked up, got sideways, and slid on down toward the first turn. You know, finally hit the inside guardrail, and, it didn't really... I really didn't hit anything hard all the way toward the car. But
you were sliding around like you're in the middle of a shooting gallery.
That's what I was afraid of. I got around to go back out on the track, and, because all the traffic was behind us, a bunch of it was behind us. And I felt like if we could get it off the track, when it did blow, I was able to cut down to the inside, and even though it got in the grass and I lost it then, I was able to at least get off the racetrack.
How do you steer one of these things with all that goo under the tires?
Well, you just turn and hope it gets hold of something, and got all the dirt and tail to the inside.
And Richard, as you can see, is okay.
First to 25th, 1 9/10 of a second. 25 cars less than 2 seconds apart at 200 miles an hour. No margin for error. Tim Richmond is leading. Newcomer Rodney Combs out of Dirt Track Racing and the American Speed Association is right there. But here comes A.J. Boyd again, and Bill Elliott is up in here. Here's number 9 Elliott from fourth into third, getting under Bobby Allison. Elliott beginning to show that Thunderbird's colors.
Haven't heard much of him since the start of the race. He fell back early, and as a result of pit stops, he's been mired down in back in the pack, but now he is beginning to run.
You're watching it live here on CBS as the assault continues by Bill Elliott in car number 9, now pulling himself into second place. And in this roaring cauldron of speed, Elliott goes after Tim Richmond. It's again a battle for the lead. Last lap, average speed, 201.2 miles per hour. Elliott pulls up, runs 3 feet away, looks inside, pulls back. Doesn't want to pull the trigger there. Bobby Allison whips right up through there. Look at that car glide. Takes it in very easily. Loose rein on number 22. For the lead, to the inside.
He'll make it look easy, Ken.
Bill Elliott out of Dawsonville, Georgia, winner of 16 Winston Cup races, the man who won the Winston Million a year ago, goes out in front.
I'll tell you what, that makes me just say, was he waiting all day? Sure made it look easy, just like Ned said. That car has always been able to dominate here. He looked pretty stout right then.
Rusty Wallace's car. Kyle Petty moving alongside and underneath him.
Now, Kyle had a little bit of a problem in the early going, but apparently whatever it was not too serious. He's been back out running since then, and I guess running in, I don't know if he lost a lap or not. We'll have to check on that.
Rusty Wallace running alongside Ricky Rudd in the Bud Moore car. Here's Bobby Allison's car closing up on Tim Richmond.
That's the only car of Bill's I saw all day that can pass like that and pull away. That's what makes you wonder if he's been saving that thing. When he can pull off like that some by himself, he's plenty stout.
It is strong.
The thing about that number 9 car is it runs fast everywhere. It's not just the straightaways. It's not just the tri-oval. Anywhere he wants to run it, and that's what's unusual. A lot of cars can run those straightaways hard, and once in a while you'll see a car make up time by really being set to use the horsepower in the corners. But this number 9, time and again, a year ago, 11 times, just put the pedal down and went wherever he wanted.
Well, now they've been able to draft back up on him as they got single file, and Dale Earnhardt has caught back up. We're going to see him. There he is, the fourth car in the picture, the yellow nose car, number 3. So you have three of the hardest chargers in the business now chasing down Elliott. Tim Richmond, he wants a piece of the lead again.
Now remember, you're watching this live on CBS this afternoon. We've completed 66 of 188 laps.
the temperature nearing 100 degrees out here at the track, where 100,000 people are watching this 2.6-mile facility. And inside the car, it's some 125 to 130 degrees warm.
Look at Earnhardt's car working down on the inside. He almost got into Richmond. He backed off just a little bit. Richmond a little bit squirrely out of that turn. But Earnhardt's car is really working now down on the low side of the racetrack. He shot by Bobby Allison over in turn two just like he was sitting still.
I thought that Richmond threw the block there and there.
Yeah, I think he did.
New record, lead changes, 19 drivers. Old record, 17 drivers, 1975.
Looks like the 27 cars had a problem falling to the inside. Rusty Wallace.
Falling off the pace. Rusty Wallace is number 27, is eased down toward turn number one. He's on the low part of the track, headed for the apron, won't even try the banking. And it's a long way around, 2.6 miles. At that pace, you know that it's terminal on car number 27, Rusty Wallace out of Missouri.
Young fellow that's had an awfully good season, particularly in the early going, Ken. He won a race over at Bristol, Tennessee. Here's a battle for the lead.
And it is a titanic struggle today with this many men fighting for first place. On the bottom of the racetrack, the yellow and blue car. That is Earnhardt, right back up there, wearing that cool suit for the first time. And Elliott running right beside him, almost leaning on him. Chevrolet on the inside, Ford on the outside. And here comes Richmond into it.
A little surprising the way that Elliott moved to the front and then pulled away for a couple of laps, but now they've caught him back and are able to pass him. But Neil works better. He likes to run out by himself rather than in traffic. He might drop back a little bit now, and then when did you get him a run again so he can clear himself of those cars? Maybe he'll wait and try to do that.
Yeah, that's kind of like riding a good racehorse. Every now and then you take that whip and hit him and see what you got under you, and then you let him rest a little bit. I believe that's more impressive.
He just took the short prop and gave him a tap.
That's right. See what he has.
Back to the pits for this report.
Okay, this is the Dan Elliott. Look at his relaxed mode of sitting here. Dan, you look like you're taking the day off.
No, not quite. Just trying to take it easy. Just trying to beat the heat.
How the brother looks like he's okay now, huh?
Well, so far, we've got a lot of race left to go, and we're just going to have to just try to stay up front.
He showed us a lot of momentary speed there. Has he been saving the car up to now?
No, we just got a bad start at first. We kind of hung him out to dry, and we've been trying to catch up ever since.
Okay, Dan Elliott a little bit on. Phil Elliott out of the number nine car. Back to you, Ken.
Rusty Wallace has just gone behind the wall. I believe he would be the fifth retiree from the race.
Some of the greatest diplomats in the world are the Elliott brothers.
Aren't they, though?
They really look worse than they did.
Yeah.
Great concern there. All right, we'll follow the action of this. There's you watching Rusty Wallace come in. We'll be back for more in the Talladega 500 after these messages.
America's 14-year-old sensation Christy Phillips goes up against some of the world's best in the American Cup Gymnastics Championships next weekend on CBS Sports Sunday. This is CBS.
People with $5,000 to $6,000 to spend assume they can't get much car for their money anymore.
It's kind of, you know, nice.
It's no Civic.
How's it drive?
It's no Civic.
Maybe we'll learn to like it.
It's no Civic.
Don't assume you can't afford a Honda Civic. It's still one of the lowest priced cars in America. Get the car at the dealer. Your New York, New Jersey, Connecticut Tri-Honda dealer.
When you're ready to go, and a good time is your game. When you want the best, Atlantis is the name. It's a fabulous place, a dream come true. Three levels of excitement, and the thrills are for you. When you hit the hot spot, it's yours for the taking. Atlantis Casino Hotel, a legend in the making. You've got to get the hot spot, Atlantis!
Dracula landlord ordered back to jail Monday. The Talladega 500 is sponsored by Unocal 76, who invite you to go with the spirit of 76. Armor All, it's the finishing touch every time you wash your car. Wrangler, a legend in jeans, made in the USA. And by Today's Head and Shoulders, for dandruff care that's good for your hair.
72 of 188 laps are down in the 18th annual Talladega 500. Ken Squier here at the Alabama International Motor Speedway, the world's fastest track, although that record is being challenged unofficially this past week. In racing news, Rick Mears with a new Chevrolet engine turned a lap at Michigan in an Indianapolis car at 222 and a half miles per hour. The closed course oval record is held at this track by the late Mark Donahue officially at some 221 miles per hour. This afternoon, here in this event, Dale Earnhardt has thrust the car number three back in front of Tim Richmond in second. Sterling Marlin has come back to third. Phil Parsons is approaching that trio in fourth. Benny Parsons is in fifth. Bobby Allison sixth. And in seventh is Buddy Baker. Eighth is Bill Elliott. What happened to Rusty Wallace? Here's the story.
Shirley, what happened?
Well, Mike, I tell you, the car was running good. You know, burned a piston. The car handled pretty good all day long. We had a little problem at the beginning with a little loose, but we cured that problem, and we're just not much you can do about it. Burned a piston. I just, sorry we had to go out like this for the folks at Kentucky Fried Chicken, now you got and all the people. They've been great for us, and we'll be back.
What about the racetrack?
Well, it's real hot out there, as everybody knows, and it's making for real slick race conditions. But it's a typical race at Talladega here when it gets hot. And just like I say, the cars are running good, and everybody looks to be running good and fast out there. So the track seems to be in good condition. It's just all around slick because of the heat. But other than that, our day was going fine for us. We're just biding our time. We wanted to be there at the end, but that's what happened.
Superstar of the future for sure, but having trouble. He won at Bristol, and then things have been turning around badly for him. Oh, does that look good this afternoon? Pass out one of those to each of those guys in those cars. Do you ever eat anything during a race, Neil?
No, maybe at Dover when we race for 5 hours, every now and then you need a snack.
Stop for lunch.
But I could take, we could take about three of those right now, couldn't we?
What do you drink? Do you drink water or anything in particular?
I mix it up. I drink just water, and then I'll take something with some sugar in it, maybe every other stop.
Ned, what did you used to drink in those old days?
I had something a little bit different. I would take a Metrical or something of that, especially in a long race. If it's going to be a 4, 5, 6 hour race, which the World 600 used to run that long, I wanted something that would give me some energy along the way. Of course, Neil mentioned sugar. I guess that would give you some energy, but it was either water and something like that. But I had a cooler inside the car that I could take on water.
Is it true that some of those guys like Weatherly and Turner sometimes used other substances?
We've heard all kinds of stories. I've never had any real proof on it, though, but there are some interesting stories from the older days of racing and some of the characters that were involved. They were tremendous race drivers, no question about that, but some of the Saturday night deals, it was a little bit different from coming out here and running 200 miles an hour.
On the back straightaway, there are the front four. There you see Earnhardt back in the lead. Tim Richmond has come into the second position, and Sterling Marlin is in third. And we have another challenge for the lead. Richmond is going to go up in front. Back into first place, and here comes Earnhardt back on the outside. Marlin in the catbird seat, third position. 130 degree heat inside these cars. Jeff Bodine gave us perhaps one of the most apt descriptions of how you can get a parallel. There's Junior Johnson looking on, the man who has cars number 11 and 12. Bodine has said that getting ready and getting into this race is like sitting in a sauna for 500 miles with your snowsuit on. He knows about things like snowsuits. He's from up around Chemung, New York. Back straightaway, another challenge. This is Sterling Marlin on the inside trying to move through.
And Ken, Buddy Baker has moved back up to fifth place. You know, they say that luck is defined as when preparation meets opportunity. Well, Baker almost lost the lap on the green flag. We saw that earlier. He was able to get it back. He was prepared, got his lap back, and now the opportunity has come, and he's right back up there in the thick of it.
As we've been telling you all day long, the weather here at Talladega, our live coverage is scorching on the track. Over 100 degrees, and the cars in excess of 120 degrees. And how do many of these drivers stay cool? Well, Mike Joy looked into the matter and filed this report.
The early days of auto racing featured a tire more appropriate to fashion than function. Appearance often took precedence over practicality. Some of racing's early heroes drove in shirt and tie, and it didn't take long for sponsor logos to make their appearance. Racers won in sport shirts, short sleeves, and coveralls. But in 1964, Fireball Roberts and two Indy drivers died in separate fiery crashes, leading to the use of coveralls dipped in a solution of borax and boric acid to make them fire retardant. The big break came in the 1960s. DuPont developed synthetic fiber for Air Force helicopter pilots, and that technology was very quickly translated to auto racing in these early single-layer Nomex suits. Double-layer and triple-layer Nomex soon followed. Here's what today's racer wears to stay safe and comfortable. A crash helmet, a fireproof suit made of fabric that doesn't breathe so it doesn't let in cool air or fire. Thus, it gets hot in here. Dennis Carlson developed a cool system for drivers. This skull cap contains a bladder through which fluid passes through a series of tubes down into this vest, which encircles the driver again with cooling fluid that exits through the... Inside the car, this coolant chest contains dry ice and coils through which the liquid coolant passes. The driver regulates his temperature off this panel. Like a thermostat, he can control his own body temperature. He has a tube connected to a thermos located behind the seat to get a drink from. But even that water doesn't stay cool for long. The floorboard temperature on this car reaches up to 140 degrees. Fortunately, on pit stops, there's a time-honored way the driver to get relief. Drink, please.
The heat is on. Yeah. The heat is on.
24 of the starting drivers in today's race have cool suits on. Among the top drivers who don't have them are Rod Combs, Bobby Hill, and Ricky Rudd, and Bobby Allison. Believe me, 5 minutes ago I put this ice-soaked rag on my head, and now it's a hot towel.
Nicely done, gentlemen. $2,500 for those suits if you want to pick one up to stay cool. Back with the race at 81 laps complete.
And Sterling Marlin appears to be having some sort of a problem. He's been running right up there with him, but he's definitely dropping back. He's down on the low side of the racetrack.
8, 9 cars. Rick Wilson just going by, and you can see that line, that car on the bottom of the racetrack for just a moment. That is the Sterling Marlin car, which is now off the pace. Up in front, Tim Richmond is there. Dale Earnhardt is second. Cale Yarborough in third. Phil Parsons in fourth. Jeff Bodine fifth. Sterling Marlin sixth. And Buck Baker is seventh.
They've got Sterling's crew sitting on pit road waiting for him to come in. They've got the board out.
188 laps the distance this afternoon. $500,000 at stake. We've already had a record set for lead changes. And here's Sterling Marlin, who was a serious contender in the early going, now coming onto pit road. Looks like the engine may have given in on that one. Here's Chris.
Okay, Sterling Marlin, the first of the contenders to make a green flag stop. He's pounding the steering wheel. He wants a drink. Right side tires and fuel, but no other work seems to be being performed on the car. Apparently it's a tire problem, and away he goes in 14 4/100 seconds. A tough break for Marlin up there with the leaders until just now. Back to you, Ken.
Fuel?
No, that was an unscheduled pit stop, very definitely. They changed the right side tires, as we saw, and Chris reported. Now, whether he had a tire going down or what the situation was, he did make an awfully good pit stop, and, of course, will stay in the lead lap. Now he needs a caution to be able to catch back up to the field.
The two leaders drawing away by some 30 car lengths. And now here's Elliott coming into the pits. This is a surprise. Bill Elliott is pulling onto pit road. Is there something to miss there? Crew is over the wall. Right side tires, have we come up that far? Are we into regular stops under green?
Well, I might have miscalculated somewhere along the way. I didn't think it was time for a regular pit.
Here's Chris.
Okay, Ernie Elliott is talking to Bill Elliott. Apparently there was some problems there. They're changing right side tires, and away he goes back out. Let's see if we can't get a word with Ernie Elliott. What was the matter, Ernie?
Yes, what did it look like?
Okay, apparently.
Did you get what he said?
Yes, apparently these are scheduled pit stops. They said Ernie was out, or Bill was out of gas there, so they're just running so fast that they're running these laps off faster than we thought.
84 laps complete, 223 miles are down.
That's kind of unusual to see Bill in one of the early cars. He usually goes quite away at this track on gasoline.
Maybe they're changing their strategy here a little today. Here's Bodine into second place. Jeff Bodine in the number five car, yellow and white, for second position.
Looks like we've got a big pack of the leaders starting to come in. Here's Cale and several of them coming in now.
Okay, so these would be scheduled pit stops.
Elliott went a lap down to the leaders with that pit stop as he came on the track and went into turn one. Front of the field overwhelmed him. Now here's Cale, there's Baker, there's the green car of Joe Ruttman on pit road. Here's Mike.
Joe Ruttman is in Cale Yarborough a little further up pit road. There's that drink of water we spoke of in the cool suit piece. Ruttman tosses the empty cup as right side tires go on. They've run 33 laps on this tank of fuel. That's just about average. The top teams will go 34 to 36 laps. Yarborough had a little quicker pit stop and beats Ruttman down the pit lane.
Continuing to lead is Richmond. Bodine maintaining second. That lead trio still staying out there. Let's see if anyone takes the opportunity to dip in here now. Baker is having a very good day. He owns his own team, Carnival 88, and he's running well. The three men up in front take another lap out here.
And Ken, Bill Elliott is still not up to speed after he got his service. Apparently he ran completely out of gas. And Neil, sometimes you can burn a piston awfully easy if you run out of gas.
These things are cut just to the limit on a fuel mixture, and there's a good chance he did hurt the engine.
Here he is back on pit road. Indeed, that may be the case. Quick change of tires. Maybe they have a tire that's equalized, but there's something amiss with this second stop on Bill Elliott.
It must be.
Here's Chris.
Okay, Bill Elliott back in the pits a second time, and it's the same side that they're working on as they did before. Now, what that problem is, I don't know. We'll have to look at this one tire, or right side tires that they've taken off. The tire appears to be okay. Both of them appear to be okay. Let's see if we can't find out from some member of the crew why a second stop was necessary. Too busy to talk here, says Ernie Elliott right now. But obviously, it's a matter of concern. Now down pit road to Mike Joy.
It is right side tires for Dale Earnhardt as well in his Richard Childress-owned car. A check of the front grille to remove any debris. And the time taken, or the late time taken, is waiting for that second gas can to empty out. A quick look at the tires off Earnhardt's car, and they look to be okay.
Tim Richmond maintaining the lead. Oh, we almost have a skirmish on pit road as a couple of cars came out. Rick Wilson almost into the side of, I believe, Bill Parsons. And Parsons showing a lot of smoke as he comes down pit road into re-entry.
I think he was spinning the tires as he came off of pit road, very anxious to get back out.
Now, those tires only stay strong for three or four laps when you come back out. Spinning tires as if you came through a bleach box on a drag strip. Does that do them any good?
Well, certainly it'll heat them up.
They get them hot in a hurry. You really don't want that. But one thing that attributes to that, Ken, is we run an open gear at this track. Most places we run, we have like a positive traction. Both wheels pull them here, just one pulls.
Here's Kyle Petty on pit road. After today, he heads back to Nashville to start his recording business as a country singer. Ricky Rudd coming back out. Here's Kyle on his way.
According to the rundowns we're getting, Ken, he's still in the lead lap. He had a problem early in the race, but it was rectified very quickly, and he still is in the lead lap.
Only six of the 40 starters have retired. They are Poncho Carter, Labonte Bierschwell, who had an engine distributor go, Richard Petty, Phil Barkdahl, and Rusty Wallace are reported out of the event. Richmond staying in front, getting pretty good range on that car, isn't he?
Yeah, but it looks like he just
fell off
the inside. He must have run out of fuel.
It looks like Richmond has run out of gas.
Might have went one lap, 2 minutes.
There he is running very slowly. The engine apparently burped going down the back straightaway.
As Ned mentioned, too, that's terrible on that engine. That thing is leaned out. When it does that, you're lucky if you can put the fuel in and get it back up to speed.
Here's Richmond limping around, crawling back toward the pits.
So that's
I believe Bodine will be your leader, his stablemate, his teammate. Jeff Bodine is in first place. And Bodine is in. So both of the Hendrick cars, Rick Hendrick, the car dealer from Charlotte, North Carolina, with stores all over the country these days, but he's in Charlotte, not here, watching on television, as both of his teams are having a problem. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Here is Tim Richmond, and Ken, I am not the least bit surprised he ran out of gas. Richmond tried to stretch this tank of fuel, 38 laps. We heard Richard Childress earlier tell us the 34 to 36 was the limit. They have refired Richmond's car and sent him on his way. Let's go to Chris.
Countdown in Bill Elliott's pit. This is the right front tire they took off. You notice this curve, it's flat. The air leaked out. They had just put it on moments before. They're still trying to find out where the leak is, and it could be a costly stop for Bill Elliott. Back to you, Ken.
91 laps complete, 242 miles are down here this afternoon in the running of the Talladega 500. On the leaderboard, car number 75, Jim Sauter would be your leader. Down there having 47. We're getting 75 as the leader. That's Morgan Shepherd's number 47. And we're waiting for official confirmation for scoring. We're in a green flag situation. See what they come up with.
47, of course, is the Jack Beebe-owned car. Jake Elder, the crew chief-owned car. He won a race at Atlanta earlier this year.
So after all of these green flag stops, car number 75 coming back on and going a lap down.
Apparently he had just taken the lead,
Jim Sauter. It took the lead.
And then went to the pits.
Lost it. So do we have Morgan Shepherd up in front?
Well, no, we'll have to wait till all the stuff down after the green flag pit stops. After the green flag pit stops.
Darrell Waltrip's number 11 is being shown as the leader. Waltrip leading at lap number 91. And we'll be back with more of the Talladega 500 after this.
Before we introduce the Daco Top Cog belt, we put it through rigorous testing to find out just how long it would last.
Broke yet?
Ain't broke yet.
And we discovered that Top Cog's revolutionary design makes it so flexible, so strong.
Broke yet?
Ain't broke yet.
That chances are it's the last fan belt you'll ever buy for your car. The incredible Daco Top Cog fan belt. Ain't broke yet.
It'll work on your dandruff.
I know. I'm just afraid of what it'll do to my hair.
Look, if I can trust my hair to it.
Today's Head and Shoulders.
It really does care for your hair.
Tough dandruff protection that works only on your scalp, not your hair. Gentle conditioners go there.
Work on your dandruff?
That I expected. But this is incredible.
Today's Head and Shoulders. Dandruff care that's good for your hair.
Now get 6.9 financing or $600 cash back direct from Ford.
This bug's for you, you're trying. You keep the dream from dying. You're one of the crew that always comes through. You keep on glory flying. You make America work. And this bug's for you.
Budweiser salutes all the men and women in uniform who proudly serve this great country.
This bug's for you.
On the lightning-fast screens of Warwick Hills, there's little room for error. Live coverage of the Buick Open on CBS Sports, next.
Alabama, 94 laps are complete at the Buick Open. There you see the story. Crenshaw, 15-under, has the lead. Paid in second. Tied with Pertzer and Love. And four are 13 under. Here at Talladega, this man just ran out of fuel, Darrell Waltrip, in the middle of the backstretch, and had to ease the car all the way around. Now, does that mean they're gambling on caution? Or they have bad radio control? What's going on here?
Well, Ned speculated earlier they might have lost radio control because we noticed that men were standing on pit road with the board for several laps. He could have lost it. Darrell just went a lap down because of that.
So Waltrip is now a lap down. Here's an interesting thing. At the halfway point of this race, 20 different drivers, one half of the starting field, have led this race. That's incredible.
It really is. I've never seen it happen.
All right, Tim Richmond's pitch. There's a story there for sure. Let's go there.
Well, Ken, you called it radio control. It's more likely radio contact. They can call that driver. It doesn't necessarily mean he'll stop. You may have left him out there one lap too often. That's risky business, playing that gas tank game, isn't it?
Yeah, it is risky. But, you know, this track here is so big that if you miscalculate one lap, sometimes it hurts. But we were okay. We've lost about 13 seconds, but we'll make it back up.
Did you really think the car could go 38 laps?
We had some caution laps in there, and we did some drafting. But the traffic was so thick, Dim couldn't come in the lap I wanted him in, and he tried to make one more.
Well, Richmond and Waltrip have run out of gas. Benny Parsons has run out of brakes. But as the famed French car builder Bugatti said in the 20s, I build my cars to go, not stop. Here's Prince.
Hyman Dale Walton and his wife Stevie said he tried to get 41 laps out of that last tank full of gasoline. Couldn't quite make it. So it tells you that the 100 miles is the key to how far a Chevy can go on one tank of fuel here. Back to you, Ken.
Great battle for the lead. Four cars. Sterling Marlin is up in there for the moment. It is the Earnhardt car, the yellow and blue, number three. Earnhardt Chevrolet is in front. On the outside, the one is Sterling Marlin. The 28 of Cale Yarborough is into it. And along with it is Jeff Bodine's number five. Now they string about single file. Down to the bottom, Earnhardt. That car seems to work so well down in that bottom groove.
I tell you, Dale and his crew like to use a wide chassis race car. They use a wide car at all the tracks.
How wide?
A 16.5-inch car, which you go to some of the cars all the way down to 55 inches. Supposedly, the narrower they are, the faster they go. When you get to a place like this where you've got a handle, that car will work in the bottom better than some of the others.
I think it was a little surprising that he qualified as well as he did on the outside pole here, 208 miles an hour with that wide chassis.
They're usually willing to give up a little speed for that handling in the race, and I think everybody in the pits knew that when he ran that fast qualifying, he'd be a big factor in the race.
We have six cars still running tight together for the lead. Usually after one of these green situations for fuel, we sort them out, but that's not the case here today. Looks like we're in for a great finish in the Talladega 500.
Only you.
Just because you've washed your car doesn't mean you're finished. After each wash, you need some Armor All. On the dash, the bumper, and especially the tires. After all, when you're in love, what's a few extra minutes? Armor All. It's the finishing touch every time you wash your car.
They say the best ones are the hard ones. These you don't break. You try to reach an agreement. And when you do, you head for the mountains. Head for the beer brewed natural as a mountain stream. For a taste as smooth as its name.
Head for Busch Beer.
Head for the mountains.
When I'm flying at real low altitude, the last thing I need is trouble. This Indy Pace car is all stock from the ground up, and AC Delco parts help make it perform. Parts that keep this car running right, and your car too. For the AC Delco retailer nearest you, just give me a call at 1-800-AC-DELCO. Stay ahead of trouble with AC Delco parts.
You're far from home, far from everything you know, but you're not alone. A new service from American Express is with you every step of the way. Announcing Global Assist. Now you can get medical and legal help in the U.S. and the world with one call toll-free 24 hours a day.
Hello, American Express.
Just one more reason to have the American Express card or to get one.
Stacy Keach stars as a man desired by women, admired by men, and scorned by the daughter who mattered most. Mistral's Daughter, Wednesday.
We're back with you live at Talladega, Alabama. Ken Squier alongside with Neil Bonnett on the injured list this week from competition. So joining us in the booth, and the two-time Grand National Champion, Ned Jarrett here. Mike Joy, Chris Economaki, pit side under caution. It just came out as Dave Marcus unhinged an engine. It's happening at the 101st of 188 laps, and that would mark us for the fifth caution of the day. 20 different drivers, one half the field, have had an opportunity to see what it looks like from the front position. Under caution once again, as they went to caution, here's how they were running. We had the three of Earnhardt up in front. In the second position was Sterling Marlin. Maintaining third was last year's winner, Cale Yarborough. And for the moment, let's go to Mike Joy.
Pit stop for Jeff Bodine. Right side tires going on as Davey Allison slides to a stop right in front of the modified speedster from Chemung, New York. Since they're under caution, they'll take occasion to take four tires, but it won't be a leisurely pit stop. These days in NASCAR racing, it's every bit as important to get to the end of pit road on the caution flag as quickly as you do on the green. Because the cars aren't running 200 miles per hour, you don't lose quite as much time on the racetrack, but it gets you in a much better position when they line up for the restart.
Field coming back out, reorganizing after this caution period. Let me go back to that lineup for a moment. As they went to caution, running in fourth position was the car number five of Bodine. Sixth was Allison. Seventh then was Sauter. Eighth was Rick Wilson. Ninth was Baker. Running in tenth was Hilton. 11th was Petty. In the 12th position was Joe Ruttman. And 13th was... Field coming back out, reorganizing after this caution period. Let me go back to that lineup for a moment. As they went to caution, running in fourth position was the car number five of Bodine. Sixth was Allison. Seventh then was Sauter. Eighth was Rick Wilson. Ninth was Baker. Running in tenth was Hilton. 11th was Petty. In the 12th position was Joe Ruttman. And 13th was Phil Parsons, with 14th Ricky Rudd. Taking a look at the attrition, we have eight cars retired from the race. There you see the list. Carter is out. Terry Labonte with an oil line early when a tire cut loose on him. Richard Petty losing an engine and in a terrible moment out here on the track. Unfortunately, he was able to walk away. Wallace has lost to the piston. Ellis is out. And let's see, since then we've had a report that Dave Marcus just now has gone away. And that brings you up to date. Let's take a look in replay, Ned, one more time at real time, normal speed from Bobby Allison's car at this incident, which could have collected several major runners and been a calamity here at Talladega today.
Well, as Bobby Allison comes off of the fourth turn, everything running very nicely and smoothly there as he watches the cars in front of him. That's Ricky Rudd directly in front of him. Allison about to make a move. We see Petty's car on the outside. The engine explodes all of a sudden. Allison doesn't know really where he's coming. He shoots right down in front of him and down onto the grass. Fortunately for everyone, he was able to move through there, not hit anyone, and he scraped the wall, of course, as he got down on the inside of the racetrack. But I'll tell you, that was a lucky move for a lot of drivers out there, including Richard Petty.
Bet. Neil, the old saw is that when you see something like that and you see someone start to spin, you aim right for them, because by the time you get there at 200 miles per hour, they're going to be gone.
It's very slow. If you'll see them set in one place, they're usually leaving that area.
We'll be back with more of the Talladega 500 in a moment. Dale Earnhardt continuing to lead.
This is an expose on the new Ford Escort EXP. Expressive, expansive, experience a new form of two-seat excitement. Ford Escort EXP.
Now get 6.9 financing or $300 cash back direct from Ford.
Quiet nights by firelight and Mars roasting almonds. These are some of the best things in life. Barefooting in ponds, splashing with swans and Mars buttery caramel. Losing your knots in all the right spots and Mars rich chocolate. These are some of the best things in life.
It's the little rewards that make life great. Mars Bar, one great little reward.
Some of the best things in life.
At 55 miles an hour, it takes the average car this long to stop, if it's in shape and has good brakes. Bendix makes very good brakes. They're not cheap. But then, neither is life.
When the car comes to the end of the line, I give them to Bill.
That's me. I crush them.
A new car costs a lot of money. Fram oil filter doesn't, but the choice is yours. You can see me now, or you can see Bill later.
Want a good reason why my antacid is Tums? I'll give you three. One, Tums is effective. It neutralizes one-third more stomach acid than the other leading brand. And that's what I take an antacid for. Two, sodium. I don't want any. And Tums is sodium-free. Three, Tums is rich in calcium. And to me, an extra source of calcium is extra good news.
America's 14-year-old sensation, Christy Phillips, goes up against some of the world's best in the American Cup Gymnastics Championships next weekend on CBS Sports Sunday.
Live at Talladega, Alabama, with 104 laps complete, 84 laps remaining, 276 miles down. The top five look like this. Dale Earnhardt first, Jeff Bodine in second, Bobby Allison in third, Jim Sauter, veteran from Wisconsin, and Cale Yarborough, defending champion in fifth. And his crew chief is standing by with Mike Joy.
Well, first, Waddell Wilson, let's talk about this race. Your car is known for coming from the middle of the pack, the back of the pack, and then all of a sudden, mid-race, you guys are a factor. Why is that always seem to be the case?
Well, this is not working like our cars normally do. It's a car we wrecked in Michigan. We put it back together, and it did not respond when we come here. And we have worked so hard. But right now, I got to give a lot of credit to Cale because he's doing such a super job driving a race car, and he's taking advantage of everything he can. And we keep working on the car, and we worked up until this morning on to try to get it better for him and make it as comfortable as we could.
This will be your last Talladega race for the Rainier Lundy team, and Waddell Wilson has only had three car owners to work with in all his years of racing: Holman and Moody, LG DeWitt, and the Rainier Lundy combination. He'll move over to join Darrell Waltrip on the new Rick Hendrick team, a third team for car owner. And I know after a couple of years of trying to make these Fords competitive and doing a great job of it after switching from GM cars, this is going to be another new challenge that you're looking forward to.
Well, it'll not be the challenge that we faced when we switched to Ford. We went into that blindfolded, more to say, and it was a heck of a challenge with the Windsor engine when Bill Elliott and all the rest of them was running the Clevelands, and we started with scratch with the Windsor and tried to make it competitive and race at the same time, and it's very difficult. And a lot of people never realized that. But going back to Chevrolet, you know, that's going like back home because we run the Chevrolet so many years and we love working with them, and with Darrell driving a Chevrolet and, you know, and Rick owning two of them. And, you know, there's a lot of input I'm going to get there, and I'm going to love this.
Well, he's a champion car builder, champion rose grower, and crew chief. Will you just build engines or will you be crew chief too over there?
No, I'll have the same role with Rick as I do here with Harry Rainier.
Then he'll be a busy man. Let's go to Chris.
Well, it's an interesting question is posed here. Seven laps after Bill Elliott and Darrell Waltrip took on four tires and fuel, they stopped again for more tires and more fuel. And the question I would ask Neil Bonnett or Ned Jarrett is, at what point would they bypass a yellow flag? And why do they stop when they really don't need tires and fuel?
Chris, I think it's just a safety factor. Whenever there's a caution on that track, it's there for a specific reason. Somebody's got some debris or oil, and it's just a simple matter. If you go through there, we usually go through the accident area one time and then turn down pit road. And hopefully, when you come back out, whatever's on the track is gone. It's a simple matter where you could pick up some debris in those used tires. It's just for four tires.
We're about ready for a restart now, Ken, as they bunch up coming off of turn four, get into the double file restart. We don't have that many cars that are a lap down, so we don't see that many on the inside.
23 in the lead lap, but we have Elliott a lap down, so he's up front on the inside, as is Waltrip a lap down. That crowd coming to their feet. They love this racetrack and this particular event.
Elliott got the lap down as a result of the extra pit stop under the green. We'll see if he can make it back up.
On the break, Waltrip comes off slowly. AJ, who has run well all day after going a lap down right at the beginning, is the third car back on the bottom of the track. As they break, Earnhardt and Bodine pull out in front, Allison maintaining the third spot. We come back to green at 106 laps, 82 remaining.
Well, we speculated a little earlier, was Bill Elliott holding back? Neil, he now has to show what he has. He's got.
You're right, and we'll find out now if he has got anything. If he's got it, he's got to show it right now.
From Bobby Allison's car, there he is trailing. This is car number nine. Remember that number nine made up a lap under green on this track a year ago to take a win. He turned the fastest 500-mile race in history at 186 miles an hour on this track. See what Elliott has in store for us today. Through the tri-over, Elliott on the high side, directly in front of Bobby Allison. Directly in front of Elliott, it's Bodine and Earnhardt. That changes. Bodine jumps up, and Yarborough down on the inside is going into second position.
Elliott got himself in a position that time he didn't want to be in when he got into that turn.
Cale making a move down on the inside. Earnhardt the leader, and we have our 21st different leader in the event. It's Cale Yarborough.
That is, if he holds the lead till he gets back to the start-finish line.
That's indeed the problem for him. Let's see if he can stand on it. You know, that happens so many times. You'll have as many as three lead changes in the lap, but they will not count. The the strike. Let's see if the counterattack is on by number three. Indeed, it is. Down to the inside. Earnhardt is going to run him down.
Well, that was close. That would have been a foot-toe finish, Ken, if it had been the last lap.
I don't think that Yarborough led it there.
I don't think he did. You know, the back straightaway at most racetracks, you take the lead, it's a surety you're going to lead. This place here is up for grabs on four.
Sterling Marlin moves in once again. He did not lead that lap out in front for a while, but not where it counted. So Earnhardt stays first. Down on the inside is the Sterling Marlin car, and he's falling back as Yarborough again comes up on the outside.
He'll be trying to, and Neil, you mentioned not on this racetrack, and the reason is that the start-finish line is so far down near the first turn.
The thing is, most racetracks, the finish line is the center of the front straightaway. This thing is almost in the first turn, which puts on a good show for the fans, though.
Well, here's Tail up to try it another time.
They're going to try a little bit of four breast stuff, see how that feels.
Bodine taking the high line in the yellow and white car, number five.
I'll tell you what, Ken, I can watch them two abreast. When they get to doing that four, that's when I want to be out there.
You really want to be in the middle of it.
Boy, that's when it's fun.
Does it pick the car up? Do you feel the car shuffle around at 200 miles an hour?
It certainly does, but if you like to race and you like speed and you like competitiveness, this is the place, and it's the wrong place to be watching, I'll tell you that.
Here's Cale down to the inside, Bodine to the high side, and there you see, oh, an interesting band. Henry Hollywood here today.
About then, we have seen Bill Elliott get down to the inside. He's going to try to follow Cale Yarborough through on the inside. He got on the outside a while ago. That was not the place to be for his particular car.
47-6 as that freight train rumbles down into turn number one.
I just can't bring myself to believe that Cale Yarborough's not going to lead a lap of this race. The way he likes to get up front, he's going to try it some more.
Back to Allison, who has skipped back a few spots now. That's Bill Parsons directly in front of him. Bill Parsons pulls up. Tim Richmond on the outside, the 25 car. These pictures live here from the Talladega 500 on CBS. Back in the lead, Earnhardt. And side by side, inside, Cale Yarborough. Outside, Jeff Bodine. Yarborough to form his own team in 1987. Waddell Wilson, the crew chief, tied the knot with Darrell Walton for their new team. Look at Baker come on in the number 88. There's the man to watch, Baker. There is no one who loves the super speedway more than Baker. Just loves to go fast. This was always his idea of a kind of racetrack.
Ken, I talked to him about the way he ran at Daytona. He ran super down there, and he told me yesterday that he's running even better than he did at Brandon Daytona, so he should be a factor for them.
Here's Baker moving on to the inside. Now, is he led earlier? I don't believe so. Baker is making a stab at it. He could become the 21st different leader. Here's Earnhardt again.
If he can do it at the line.
The spoiler, number three, coming back. Buddy Baker, previously a winner as a driver, trying for the first time as an owner to win. Owner and driver, Buddy Baker of Charlotte, North Carolina, 6'5", 240 pounds. He's suit for the first time. He's always called them sissy suits. Changed his mind way up in the marbles for a moment. And Earnhardt back on the inside.
But Baker did get credit for leading that lap. He maintained it to the start finish line.
21 different leaders. You're watching a record breaker here today.
You know, that fourth car just keeps popping up in the front. And he's working hard, and that thing is, you know, there's a different crew of characters up there all the time, but that four is always right there in the middle.
Morgan McClure
car is working well. Ken, the last time by, Rusty Wallace is back on the racetrack in the car number 27, but he has a lot of smoke coming from the car. He got the black flag the last time around.
Also out back there with him is that Buddy Arrington car, which you mentioned at the top of the show. Buddy Arrington, of course, has lost two cars really hard this year. Pocono, Pennsylvania earlier this year. Had a terrible crash. Then at Michigan, of course, in qualifying for the race you saw on CBS, he had another incident.
Of course, that was Rick Baldwin was attempting to qualify his car there. Rick slammed into the wall on his qualifying lap, and he still is unconscious in Texas Hospital. Of course, our prayers and best wishes continue to go out to Rick Baldwin, who last month.
Here's Rusty Wallace, and to all his family, of course. It's a hard one. And it's a hard one on Buddy Arrington, a guy who cares so much about the sport. And Rick Baldwin was a guy who was working with him. That was a small team trying to make their way.
Really, Rick was doing him a favor, just trying to make his way into this business. The yellow flag is coming out, apparently, from the smoke or oil maybe that Rusty Wallace put on the track.
So that's caution number six here this afternoon at Talladega. No chance for a record. Overall record 186 miles an hour, what, 174 miles per hour in this race. So we're under caution for the sixth time. We may get 22 or 23 different leaders because there's still men like Cale Yarbrough that have not had a chance to lead.
I don't think the four's led. He's been right there in it all along.
That's right. Cale has led some, but not at the start-finish line.
Yeah, Earnhardt's making everybody wear their racers out. They mark them down and take them back off.
Here's Kenny Schrader, last year's Rookie of the Year winner on the circuit, being pushed behind the wall.
Junie Donlevy car, number 90 out of Virginia, okay, Schrader out of Missouri. There's Chris right with it. Chris?
Okay, down here with Kenny Schrader. He's about to get out of the car, which is really smoking and hot. They've pushed him off the track. Oh, tough break. There goes the hood is being lifted now to check on it. You got any idea what the trouble was, Kenny?
I don't really know yet, Chris, but it was real important down in the bottom of the engine. It come apart big time. We was really happy with the way the car was running. It was doing a good job, David. We'll try again next week.
What's it been like in the car with all this heat?
Well, we're trying a new Carlson cool suit today, and it's really working super, Chris. It wasn't bad at all.
Okay, now let's go down pit road to Mike Joy.
Dale Earnhardt getting service. Again, refuses a cold drink as he did earlier, and left side tires. We'll go on his machine now. The tires coming off look fine. They get the last drop of gas in, and away he goes. Buddy Baker was leading right up to the caution flag, and this is not the car Baker wanted to have here today. The machine that he nearly won the firecracker at Daytona was damaged too badly after hitting the wall, and this is a backup car that they usually run on shorter speedways. All that considered, he's doing a terrific job just to get up and challenge for the lead.
115 laps down. 188th the distance. Record crowd for this event, we believe. Standing by to watch for a tremendous finish. And we'll continue with more live action from the Talladega 500 after this word from your local stations.
Colorado's beautiful Castle Pines Golf Club will play host to a new PGA event coming up on CBS Sports. The top names in golf will compete in a unique format that encourages aggressive play. Points will be awarded for each hole, and at the end of each round, only those in the top half of the field will advance. It promises to be the ultimate in spectator excitement. The International on CBS Sports. This is CBS.
If a romp down a road like this doesn't make sense to you,
then this car probably won't either. The new generation Mazda RX-7 pours out power as smooth as silk, as only a rotary can. And nothing has a more advanced suspension system. You can pay a whole lot more for a sports car and still not have this much fun.
Say, aren't you the driver of this new RX-7? Hi.
Hi. Oh.
Motor Trend Magazine's Import Car of the Year, Mazda RX-7.
They came to New York from all over the world. They came to make a contribution and to compete with the best of them. Some stayed, some headed west, and some of those who did came back.
The company that's about to publish the new York Yellow Pages may have offices all over America, but the people who sell it are from New York. And in a way, aren't we all?
An exclusive interview with Stevie Wonder, Monday.
116 laps are now complete, 308 miles, 72 laps to go in our live coverage of the Talladega 500. The speed has really come backward here, down to 158 miles an hour as we've come through our sixth caution period. Bulletin, Germany, Hockenheim, Grand Prix, Formula One is over. Nelson Piquet of Brazil wins it. Ayrton Senna finishes second. That's another Brazilian. And Nigel Mansell of Great Britain places third. Now, Mansell finishing third today, that'll put him on top in the World Championship standings with Prost in second, Senna third, Piquet fourth, and Rosberg fifth in the World standings. Next week, these units will be dormant. 2 weeks from now, they'll be on their way to Watkins Glen. And because they're dormant, Operation Hayride takes place. A fellow named Johnny Hayes has put together one of the darndest ideas for these fellows that work on Winston Cup cars all season long. They're going to get a weekend off to go haying in Ohio.
It's something that just spread like wildfire through the garage area. Eddie Thrapp actually came up with the idea, passed it along to Johnny Hayes. They worked for the same company in racing, and once they mentioned it in the garage area, it just spread. And what they're going to do is take the tractors that pull those trailers we saw a moment ago. They'll have flatbed trailers that'll haul hay, go up, leave from Charlotte, North Carolina, next Friday morning, and go up to Ohio to pick up hay to bring back to the drought-stricken areas of the South.
60 loads. What I want to know is who's going to do the pitching on and pitching off.
Well, I don't know. Now, a lot of the drivers are going to make the trip as well as the
Cale fellows. Yarbrough said he was going.
As well as the fellows who drive the trucks.
Westbound and down, out there to Ohio, and then eastbound. I wonder if they'll stay at 55. Let's get down to the pits. Here's Mike Joy.
Well, you're looking at Ricky and Linda Rudd, and Ricky, again, would like to be in there for the finish of this one. But you talk about hot out there. Rusty Wallace, whose car has just retired, is now in relief of Ricky, and Ken Schrader is standing by. Are you okay?
Yeah.
As okay as you can be on a day like this?
Well, the main thing, I've had the flu bug, and I still got it for the last 10 days, and you know, I'm just not 100%. I'm only about 60%, and the hot weather's just really been working on me today.
Well, I know you're one of 16 drivers without the cool suit or the cool hat. Do you think that might have been a factor allowing you to stay in the car longer?
Well, that might have helped me, especially since I've been sick. This is the first time I can remember getting out of car since about 1978. So, you know, with this flu bug and stuff, it was hard enough to try to climb in the car, let alone try to run like we've been doing. So I think Rusty will do a good job for a while until we get a chance to get a breather here.
On the same front, Morgan Shepherd's car had the hood loosen up so that hot air came out from the engine compartment and it went right into the cooling scoop that leads inside the car. They had to blank that off, and Shepherd will have to tough it out the rest of the day. Here's Chris.
Well, we all know that for 1987, Darrell Walden was changing teams. Cale Yarbrough has announced that he wants to form his own team so that he can get some experience as a car owner so he can continue in racing after he's too old to drive. But this is a time of the year when everybody's talking about who's going to drive for whom. Terry Labonte does not have his contract for 1987 set as yet. He told me this morning, Ricky Rudd is another one who does not have his contract set. And when one driver moves, it sets up a domino effect. Now, Davey Allison is here, and Sterling Martin is looking good on the track in car number one. And it looks as though many newcomers will be coming to the fore when the 1987 season rolls around. That's it.
Couple of new teams out there. That is really going to change the equation considerably, the balance of power within racing, which I think has changed anyway. And Chris's point is well taken. And you notice among the Chevrolet teams for which you have driven, Neil, already the Hendrick stable have come up with really stout organizations on the Chevrolet side. And there's no question that Richard Childress' team is now perhaps the most formidable anywhere in racing.
It's not just a coincidence. On a day like today, there's 20-something lead changes. There's 20-something teams capable of doing that. The drivers have been there in the past. There's always a good group of drivers to draw from to put in these race cars. What's happened in the past few years, the good quality teams are built. There's more cars out there. As long as they keep building good cars, those drivers are going to surface. So that right now, there's no such thing as one guy having the inside track. All the Chevrolet guys get the same equipment. The Ford guys get the same equipment. In turn, the competition is awful tough.
The leader, as we get prepared to start, is the Combs, car number two. But we're told that Alan Kulwicki, who lost an engine a little while ago, blew an engine, is now taking over in car number two. Rodney Combs, who was the champion of the National Dirt Racing Association back in 81, the 36-year-old dirt track star, has stepped out of his car, and Alan Kulwicki, an ASA champion, has got an opportunity. As they shuffle him out, get down for that start. Car number five makes short work of everything, and it is Bodine going for the lead. 21 cars on the lead lap as we get back under green.
And Ken, the car number two was in the lead until he made the pit stop for that driver change. Of course, he's back in the pack now, and Bodine is at the head of the pack.
As they go down the back straightaway, number five, Bodine, and here comes Rick Wilson, another time. Wilson in car number four. Will he stay in front for a lap?
He has not led so far this year, but as Neil Bonnett pointed out earlier, he's almost destined to because the car has run so strong all day long, and he's out front now as he comes off of turn four. If he can hold it back to the start finish line.
That's a pretty good job. More than it seems like he's going to lead back here.
120 laps complete as they come to the stripe. Rick Wilson becomes the 22nd different leader among 40 drivers who started this race this afternoon. 35 lead changes among 21 is up on the top of the docket. 67, I believe, is the record.
Something seemed to happen to AJ right in the middle of the pack. He's falling way back.
There's Rick Wilson, the leader Bodine in second place. Bodine seeming to be willing to wait at this point.
And maybe he can't do anything about it.
So Richmond pulls up on the inside.
That four car is very strong.
The first time we saw the car get out there, they were just having to see what it could do in the front.
Wilson has had a couple of cars get loose on him and take some wild rides on Super Speedway, and it hasn't bothered him a smidgen. He just keeps coming back and getting stronger. He really likes to run fast, and you have to enjoy it to do it on this track.
There's a lot of other things you can be doing. You can be fishing today if you don't want to go fast. This thing here, this boy drives this car because he's good at it, and he's wanting to be better. Right there is the best lesson you have.
Richmond, who could be the spoiler here, pulls up in that third spot. Back to the pits. Here's Chris.
Well, the coolest seat in all of Alabama is right here in Bill Elliott's pit. It's a 300-pound block of ice that they brought here this morning for the crews to sit on between the work they do and the stop. And there's another one up in Buddy Baker's pit, too. And I'm going to stay here for the rest of the afternoon, I think.
The Polar Bear Award going to Chris Economaki.
Now, that's what you call taking care of your pit crew members. Of course, Chris has sort of commandeered that block of ice.
Yeah, they're going to have an awful time getting him off that thing. 122 laps are down. There's Wilson in front. Bodine in second. Some 100,000 are here this afternoon in this blazing heat. Scorching, steamy day. Enjoying this great race. Notice that car number two is beginning to make a move on the inside. It looks like Earnhardt is on his way back to the front another time. Davey Allison is also up in it. Bobby Allison is in it, Benny Parsons, all up there in the top 10. More of the action with 123 laps now complete after these messages.
These are the signs of Mr. Goodranch. Signs of special skill and straightforward quality. Signs of sophisticated technology. Signs you can trust. Signs of quality parts and service. Look for the signs of Mr. Goodranch wherever you see these signs and this signature. No one knows your GM car better than Mr. Goodranch. No one.
In May of 1986, we asked hundreds of business people to make a choice and tell us which one sounded better, a typical AT&T long-distance call or a fiber-optic call made on U.S. Sprint.
Tremendous clarity. The difference is obvious.
After just one call.
Sound and deeper and not any interference at all. And I like the second one a lot better.
Three out of five people preferred the fiber-optic clarity of U.S. Sprint.
It was great.
It's great.
Tremendous difference.
Have you tried it, Sam?
Mm-hmm. It's definitely clearer.
Three out of five preferred U.S. Sprint.
Sounds like I'm calling Mr. Miller right in the other office.
Three out of five after just one call.
This is perfect. Interesting. And Sprint sounds like it's about 100% better than AT&T.
If I had my druthers, I'd sure as use it over the present system we're using.
So call now. Find out more and save with U.S. Sprint, where every fiber optic call sounds like you're right next door.
Don't you know me? I'm your native son.
Willie and Wrangler, a legend in jeans.
I'll be gone 500 miles.
Made in the USA.
Is done.
What's the NFL today, really? I'm glad you asked.
I can tell you what the show is.
Clear reporting, facts.
It's intuition, instinct, behind-the-scenes information you can't find anywhere else.
The NFL today in two words.
In three words.
No, two words. Brent Musburger.
In three words. Jimmy the Greek. Take Jimmy handicapping a tough game like the Bears and the Cowboys.
And take Brent interviewing a quarterback like Jim McMahon.
Well, some folks say Jimmy's a little too loose in his style.
Yeah, some people say Brent's a little uptight.
Who says?
Teamwork. That's what it's all about.
126 laps complete, 62 remaining. In the Talladega 500, 18th annual, for $500,000. Great battle for the lead. Bodine is in front, but here comes Earnhardt on the inside. Got live pictures, follow them down into turn number three. At better than 200 miles an hour. As they say up in the state of Maine when they race, they're running clabbered to clabbered. And here comes Cale on the bottom of the racetrack, up into third.
On the outside, Tim Richmond is there. That's four. Rick Wilson, notice he's back in fifth. He was up there for the lead. He sailed back about eight positions in about 15 seconds. Looked like he had a little trouble with the draft at that point.
Well, I think he scrubbed the wall a little bit.
Scrubbing the wall just a little right here. Let's watch it in replay as to how he came back.
He was in the lead, of course, and just scraped that wall coming off at turn four.
And it set him back to where he is now as we come back to live pictures, running in fifth, regrouping and coming back. Inside of the racetrack, that looks like Bobby Hillen making a move. Hillen is up in there.
Buddy Baker's in the pits right now, Ken, an unscheduled pit stop. He was up there among that front pack.
And was getting loose.
Yes. I can't help but think he had something wrong because he just barely missed wall two, three laps in a row before that.
Side by side for the lead. Back to the line. Three has it by just about 2 feet. Here's Mike Joy with the latest retiree.
Indianapolis's all-time winner A.J. Foyt had a good run here last year, finished fifth. It looks like all the good luck you had last year came back and bit you here this afternoon.
Well, it wasn't real good last year. You know, we lost a lap, or we'd have ran second in the race. But somewhere we got a lap down, they said. But today we started off real good, and I cut a right rear tire. And lucky I didn't get in the wall. Then I went out and run some more, and I cut two more tires. And a while ago, I lost the left front wheel bearing for some reason, went out.
The car looked like it almost hit the wall when you did.
It almost did, almost went head on, but I don't know, it's been a year, I thought last year, my picture's even worse.
AJ, how different is the racetrack? How different is the competition here at Talladega, 1 year to the next?
Well, it was real good. I thought competition was good. You know, we were like three laps down, and I was running right there with them. As far as a good group of guys to run with, I really enjoy them. They're not a bunch of crybabies, they're just true racers, you know.
Are there more cars in contention today, it seems, than a year ago?
Oh, I don't think more than a year ago. No, it's been this way for the last 5 or 6 years down here.
That's A.J. Foyt.
The leaders have been caught up in this astonishing battle. Some 15 are now in a position to battle for the lead. For the moment, Bodine has the spot. You see Richmond holding on in second. Earnhardt in third. Bobby Hillen, the 22-year-old from Texas, has come up into fourth. Rick Wilson of Bartow, Florida, maintaining the fifth position. And right behind that group, some other strong candidates. Cale Yarborough, for instance. Joe Rutman. And a dozen more. More of the action here at the Talladega 500. Whoa, loose for a moment. Picks it back up. We'll be back with all the action in a moment.
When I'm flying at real low altitude, the last thing I need is trouble. This Indy Pace car is all stock from the ground up, and AC Delco parts help make it perform. Parts that keep this car running right, and your car too. For the AC Delco retailer nearest you, just give me a call at 1-800-AC-DELCO. Stay ahead of trouble with AC Delco parts.
Sure, your performance tires perform in perfect weather. But it's not a perfect world, is it? Introducing the Goodyear Ego GT Plus 4. A dramatic advance in tire design that gives you great street performance in all kinds of weather. So you can take those turns, hit those brakes, and run down those highways, even when less than perfect. Look, you either have Goodyear Egos, or you need them.
Speed, heat, endurance, the triple test of NASCAR racing. Quaker State Motor Oil is here, performing, protecting, flowing continuously under extreme conditions. And it's the same oil you can buy right off the shelf. Quaker State technology delivers protection in your car and on the track.
Quaker State, the big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will.
I'm in a bar. And there she is, so I go for it. She's drinking Sun Country Wine Cooler. Hey, I see you're drinking the refreshing real juice cooler. She ignores me. So I try the line about how everyone loves the premium white wine and real fruit juice in Sun Country. Then I make my big move and order my own Sun Country. Then she makes her big move. She leaves. Sun Country, say, give me the real juice cooler. The last time I wear a bear suit to a singles bar.
Sit down, AJ.
Where?
Tuesday, sit in with Simon and Simon.
I want you to tell me every little detail.
Professionals, they have the respect of those around them.
Watching it live as it unfolds. International Motor Speedway, the world's fastest racing oval. The Talladega 500. The standings in the 18th annual shootout. Bodine is first. Earnhardt second. Richmond third. Yarborough coming then next. And Rick Wilson fifth. Alongside today, Neil Bonnett, who would like very much to be out here, but broke himself two or three ribs. Tore up his shoulder blade. Broke that crash in Pocono a week ago, and he hopes they're running in Watkins Glen, New York in 2 weeks. Neil, you've got remarkable recovery power.
Well, I'll tell you what, I gotta get to work. I've been working four times a day. I gotta get busy.
He'd like to be sitting right in that car. 40 years old this week, huh? Your pit crew were telling stories on you. Your birthday's Wednesday.
I'll be 40 in about 3 or 4 days, and used to when the wall up. Now when I hit the wall, it hurts.
That's Neil's car right there. Davey Allison is driving it, the car number 12. It's reported, I believe, in 10th position now. Bobby Allison making a charge on his son. The Alabama gang, they really stick together.
Get him, Davey. Don't let him do that.
Let's check in with Harry Gantz, car number 33. Further back in the field.
He's farther back in the field, running along behind Morgan Shepherd, but they're all still in contention. There are about six cars up that lead pack in, and then about a second behind them is about 15 or so cars that have really been battling for positions.
Ned, at this, there's Sterling Marlin into the pits. At this point, do you just kind of wish it's over, Ned, when you're driving?
I think you're having fun, especially if you're running up front. Still in, you're having fun. You want to go on a while, and if you are up front, now that fellow in the lead says, yeah, I wish it could end this next lap, but those guys that have some making up to do, no, they want to go on.
The fun's yet to come. You know, you've been sitting there sweating all day long, trying to figure out what to do. I guarantee Earnhardt knows just as well what that five car to do as his car. He's ready to make his move when time comes.
Charlie Marlin got back out, stayed in the lead left, Ken, so it'll be interesting to see if he can do that with those cars drafting each other.
Buddy Arrington out of Martinsville, Virginia, lost an engine on car number 67. That's the sadness as he tries to come back after so much misfortune for that team this year. There you see Bodine first, and now Yarborough. It looks like he wants to flex a little muscle. The car number 28, the Rainier Lundy team. What will become of the Rainier Lundy team next year with all this major change? Loses a driver, Yarborough to form his own team, Waddell Wilson to join Darrell. What's the speculation?
Harry Rainier told me last week at Pocono that they definitely were going to stay in business. They've made Cale an offer for him to stay. It's not absolutely definite that he'll do his own, but he's leaning in that direction. But Rainier says that they'll pick up another driver and go forward, Neil.
And J.T. Lundy and Harry Rainier, as established they are in the sport, they're excellent people, caliber people you want to have teams in this sport. They've already hired Robert Yates to go over and start the engine program for Cale for the remainder of the season, so they'll get him a good team going.
Let's watch 360 degrees, just as if you were sitting up here in one of those top seats in the stands. Here they are coming down out of second turn into that 3,000-foot backstretch. You see Bodine in the lead now. Couple of car lengths. Earnhardt just sitting there right where he wants to be. Yarborough would like to be in front of the two of them. Richmond is still there in fourth. Remember now, he's won three of his last four races. Tim Richmond, the fourth place man. Rick Wilson, having the best run of his entire career today, maintains fifth, while Phil Parsons is sixth. Joe Rutman, seventh. Bobby Hill in eighth. Davey Allison, ninth. Bobby Allison, tenth. Jim Sauter's 11th. And there's that low speed shot that gives you some idea of the overwhelming power of these 3,700-pound cars.
Phil Elliott is running along behind those first five, but he has not been able to pass them. He's a lap down. He got a lap down earlier as a result of an extra pit stop. We thought that he had the strength to get back up there, but he has not been able to get back up there, pass them, and get back in the lead lap. So maybe his car is not as we thought it was earlier.
Here you are with that battle still on for the front running position. It fits Jeff Bodine against Dale Earnhardt, and it could go that way right to the wire. We'll follow it for you here on CBS.
They auctioned off my Pioneer. Daddy bought it. That's when I first met him.
I love that story, Mama.
And I love your cooking, honey.
Well, Crisco's what makes it taste so special.
Mmm, that pie looks real tempting.
Wait till you try it.
The filling is rich and chocolatey, but nothing makes my crust flakier than Crisco.
Mmm, that just melts in my mouth.
And Crisco has no cholesterol. Now, honey, what will you bid for second?
Is that enough?
Wow! Crisco will do you proud every time.
Hey, Pete. Going to town with us?
Ah, go ahead. Looks like you had a little trouble.
Ah, we can take care of it.
A day off is something real special, but so's a good neighbor.
Going into town with us, Pete?
Head for the beer brewed natural as a mountain stream, for a taste as smooth as its name.
Bush. Head for Bush Beer.
Head for the mountains.
Have you dreamed of war? When was the last time you had the kind of car to bring the road alive?
Have you dreamed of war?
Sometimes brakes can give you a gentle hint that they need a little work.
Take it to Midas.
Over 4 million people have trusted their brakes to Midas. Good price, good guarantee. We won't break you.
Whoops.
Take it to Midas.
Whoops.
Take it to someone you trust.
On the lightning fast cruise. There's little room for error. Live coverage of the Buick Open on CBS Sports next.
At Talladega, Alabama, we're having one of the most competitive races of the year. And at Grand Blanc, Michigan, the same is true of the Buick Open in golf. Look at that leaderboard. Sneed, Toole, Crenshaw, Pertzer, all 15 under and tied at 14 under. We'll be going to the Buick Open following the Talladega 500 this afternoon here on CBS. Dale Earnhardt is in front. Now, Rusty Wallace has taken over for Ricky Rudd in car number 15. And he is just, he normally drives that 27 car. Over for an ailing Ricky Rudd, who's had the flu for several days. And he's brought that car from the rear of the field back up into contention.
He's doing, you know, I noticed when he got in the car on the restart, he was extra cautious and was back out of the pack. And he's worked his way back up into contention.
12th position.
Yes.
12th position, yeah.
That is, that's a little bit more of a change than people realize. The speed is not the factor that you're used to it. It's kind of like sitting in your den. You're used to that easy chair. You're used to that hill. That car is made for Ricky Rudd, not Rusty Wallace.
And Ricky Rudd is one of the shorter drivers on the circuit. Rusty Wallace, a good 6-footer, 5'11".
Well, he's got that 6-foot on the floor right now. That's worth it.
And Neil, would, I was about to ask Neil, is there a difference in the... Wallace was driving a Pontiac. This is a Ford that he's driving now. Can you feel the difference in the makeup cars?
I've done it before, Ned. You know, we're always complaining and driving. That guy's got a better car. This is better. That's better. They actually have better. But some of them get in the corner better with aerodynamics. Some of them run better down the straightaway. I'm sure Rusty's having a good time seeing what that thing feels like.
143 laps are complete. Here's Mike Joy.
This oil pump belt is the reason for Erickson's car being in the garage. Another reason has got to be the heat. Buddy, I know even if they can fix this car, you don't look like you really want to go back out there.
Well, I don't so much reckon. I don't really know what you're saying, but all I can say is it's the hottest I've been in the race car, and I really didn't mind coming in. But we're gonna try to put an oil pump belt on the car and go back out. It broke a belt. I seen it just as it broke, and I don't think it hurt anything. So we're going to put a belt on the engine and go back out and try it.
You finished third here once, but this season has been such a terrible one for you. Totaling a car at Pocono, Rick Baldwin crashing very badly, totaling a car at Michigan. It's been a rough second half.
Yeah, it's been a rough whole year. It's been a rough, worst year we've ever had since I've been here racing. 22 years of racing, and I can't remember going through what we've been through this year.
You don't run the cool suit. Do you have one, or have you tried one?
What?
Have you tried a cool suit? Have you tried wearing one?
No, but...
Even at $3,500, even the independent drivers are going to have one.
His best finish ever was third in the 79 Alabama 500. Buddy Arrington, he had a fifth back in 72. Something's happened to Bill Elliott's car number nine. It's off its speed, falling back. Car number nine is being overtaken by a whole host of cars at this point, and I wouldn't be surprised if we saw him pit next time by. The average speed is staying 157 miles per hour. We've completed 145 laps, and up in front, Dale Earnhardt, Bodine, Richmond, and Yarborough look like they're going to decide it. And for the moment, Earnhardt and Bodine are drawing away from the remainder of the field.
That's the first time all day we saw that. And if you look right here in this shot, they're right on the apron. With left side tires down there, those two cars are able to run lower than any cars on the racetrack. Since they started doing that, they started pulling away.
Has to be a little slippery up in the middle of the group where most of them have been running. Here's Chris Economaki and Bill Elliott.
Okay, Bill Elliott is in for what appears to be an unscheduled stop. The interesting thing about this stop is they'll have 42 laps to go. Once the race, he gets out of here, and that's just a little bit more than he'll have fuel for. Apparently, it's a tire situation, and away he goes, and it's 15 and a half seconds in the pit for Bill Elliott, who's already one lap down.
Bill Elliott coming back out, 110 degrees at the track. You can imagine what it's like inside those automobiles.
Now, Bill Elliott finds himself two laps down as the leaders went by as he was coming out of the pits. So he really has a lot of making up to do.
There's been days when that was done. He was two laps down once before, but today just seems to be just a little bit off. I like you earlier, Ned. I thought he could come back from that one lap deficit, but he just hasn't been able to get up to speed.
And he isn't getting up to speed at all as he comes out this time. He's on the apron down at the bottom of turn number two going into the back straightaway. Something is truly amiss on Dawson Thunderbird, driven by Bill Elliott. Boys in the pool hall in Dawsonville aren't going to be tickled about this one. Here's Cale Yarborough down to the inside. Is that Bobby Hillen alongside?
Cale seems to be off the pace just a little bit. Go by him.
Just a tad. Cale Yarborough coming back.
As he won this race a year ago today. His first win after going with the Ford for that team last year.
First time he won this race, too. Tough one for him. The leader. Again, Richard Childress' team with that blue and yellow number three. Just they've organized so well. And they put together a car that looks bulletproof. Phil Parsons on pit road. Jeff Bodine staying second. And the decision may be between those two, but they all have one more pit stop to make. We'll be back with more of the action here at Talladega, Alabama, in the 18th annual Talladega 500 after this word from your local stations.
CBS asked me to pick out some of my all-time favorite Magnums, and I told them that was a tough call. So they gave me these.
Magnum Tuesdays, all summer long.
This is CBS.
Here's how a typical business uses the Bell Atlantic business-to-business directory.
I need 3 million wing nuts. Find them.
Found them.
I need some help with my calculator.
I've got your...
The machine won't copyright.
I copy.
I need a new T-square.
You got it.
Get me new lights, please.
In a flash.
Collators.
Rubber stamps.
Toggle switches.
You got it.
So use it. The Bell Atlantic business-to-business directory, where business is looking up.
When you're in the business of saving lives, you better not let your transmission die. That's why many ambulance fleets go to AMCO. It does better than fix your transmission. They rebuild it to perform like new. Ambulances can't take unnecessary risks. Should you? Go where you know it's better than fixed. It's AMCO. AAMCO.
Dracula landlord ordered back to jail Monday.
38 laps to go, and the leaders are pitting, and they're going to tanks right to the bottom. Thimble thin when this one's over this afternoon, if they can go the distance.
Well, there was about 38 laps to go when Earnhardt, who we see back out on the track, he beat Jeff Bodine out of the pits. They came into the pits together. They were together on the racetrack. You see them coming in for their service, but they had about 38 laps to go. I don't think they can go that far on gas. Some of them might try. They're pitting very close together on the racetrack, but Earnhardt beat second or a second and a half.
Now, let me ask both of you, 38 laps. Neil?
it's going to be tough. You know, it's going to be a gamble, and it might enter in who's drafting, who's saving a little bit of fuel, who can roll out of the throttle just a little bit. Might make the big difference.
Gary Hyde got a little thin at 38.
And Richmond had just made a pit stop before Bodine and Earnhardt's. He made a pit stop a lap earlier. So they...
Rick Wilson is the leader, but he's pitting right now in car number four. I believe this will give the lap to Bobby Hillen. He's also in that group coming on pit road.
Rusty Wallace coming in 15.
I think that may put Kyle Petty first. Kyle Petty in car number seven, I believe, is the leader as we move along into the 151st lap. Wilson's number four coming in. Here's Chris.
I'm with Richard Childress, Dale Earnhardt's car owner. Is this going to be a replay of the Daytona 500, Richard? Do you have enough gas to go the distance?
It's going to really, really be close.
38 laps. You can't go 38 laps on a tank full?
I don't know. It's very doubtful. I'd say about 36 or 7 is going to be maximum.
Darrell Waltrip got 40 and a half.
Darrell Waltrip spinning.
That was Darrell.
Okay, so here we have what looks like a replay of the Daytona 500 between Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Bodine, with Earnhardt obviously not having enough fuel to go to the end. He gets within two laps of the finish, so he's going to have to come in late if there's not another yellow flag for a splash of gas to make the checker. Back to you, Ken.
Chris, we have a replay of what happened here with Rick Wilson and Waltrip.
Okay, and Wilson was leaving his pits as Waltrip was coming in. Wilson, of course, didn't see sent Waltrip spinning around. Wilson goes on. I don't believe it did too much damage to his car, but Waltrip, it looks like, maybe backed into
that crew scrambling. I think everybody got away and got over the wall. Scary moment down there.
Something to look at. The seven car never has pitted yet. He hasn't pitted. And when he comes down, he's going to have that edge on making the distance.
He might be able to make it.
He could be the only car left that could do it.
152, is that the tally?
Every 36 laps, but we have a
showdown.
That all goes out the window.
Caution is out. Turn number two, it's car 81. Chet Phillips' car in trouble. Chet Phillips, number 81, so it's academic. Everybody comes in, fuels up.
Now they'll be able to
finish
now.
We're going to have today. This will bunch them all back up. Seventh caution of the afternoon. Earnhardt is showing some smoke here in car number three. Dale Earnhardt.
The current point leader trying to win his second championship in this series of NASCAR. He's had some trouble in previous races.
Going in.
Luck has been going out with the tide recently.
It sure has, and that, Neil, looks like it's coming from the engine, too.
Yeah, and he's making an awful wide swing right there.
Right into the garage area. And he spins it around, right into some crew members there. Hopefully they all got out of the way as Harry Gant was coming down pit road. His crew was out there ready to service him, and Earnhardt.
I started to say it looked like rear end grease or oil coming up out of the car, evidently spun in his own oil coming in there.
Let's take a look at exactly what happened to Earnhardt's car. Well, that's a battle zone down there along pit road.
Well, he was making the wide squeak, Ken, as attempting to go into the garage area. That's the way that they do it when they head in, and he turned the car and it looked like it was headed right in there, and all of a sudden it just broke loose. The back wheels looked like they were locked up.
I think that's liquid, coming off. He might have just either been going too fast, but looked like there was something coming out of the car.
And well, this 33 right on going.
They moved right out of the
way.
Didn't
miss a beat.
I'll tell you, those fellas are in good condition, too. They're athletes, really.
Either that or self-preservation one, I'm not sure which.
Meanwhile, in the backstretch, Chet Phillips is enjoying the sun.
Chet, a young driver from Texas who has a lot of desire, as most of these drivers do out here, wants to make it on this circuit, which he knows is the toughest in the world to make it on. But he has run awfully good, had some very good runs, even though he's a rookie on the circuit.
And you saw Buddy Arrington belt replacement, and Arrington's back on the track. 13 cars have retired with Earnhardt out. Waltrip coming back in again, as well as Cale Yarborough. Back on the track comes Tim Richmond. Here's Mike.
Henry Benfield is putting the gas in this car. The regular gas man got a gash on his head when he jumped over the wall, and Darrell Spoon coming down pit lane the first time. Waltrip was actually on pit road when the caution flag came out, but car owner Junior Johnson set him around. It'll be a four-tire change. That's standard procedure under the caution flag. And Benfield will try to get every drop of gas in that car that he can. He's one of those car hauler drivers that Ed talked about earlier. He'll be going up to Ohio to take up a load of hay. And almost. Well, it's a traffic jam on pit road. An Alphonse and Gaston routine. And Bill Elliott is the car that ends up stopped. Chris.
Okay, I'm in the number 15 pit. Ricky Rudd's car that was taken over by Rusty Wallace. Ricky Rudd is very interested in what's happening in this pit stop. And tire changes on both sides. The car has a crack. It looks like there's water on the windshield, but the left door is stove in front of the left rear wheel. This car has had a battering on the track. And now down pit road to Mike Joy.
Oh, when Bill Elliott's car stalled, he was unable to get it restarted. Bernie Elliott flew underneath the air cleaner and looking at the ignition system. Those black boxes, not just on the Fords, but all these cars, have given their problems this year. They're making an adjustment at the distributor, and they're fitting a new coil. They're now removing the cover that keeps heat coming off the headers from getting up in the area of the carburetor and having a look at spark plug wires. But old $1 million Bill looked like he could be felled here by as little as a $3 or $4 part.
Flag, 156 laps down, 32 to go, so everybody is within range of the checkered flag. And we'll be down to see that finish. Ken Reagan led briefly, back in action after he crashed here in 85 and broke his neck and led for a moment. Now he's pitted. We'll be back with a restart in the finale in a moment.
Behind this wall, research in behavior modification has been completed. The result? Escort GT, a startling transformation of the world's best-selling car, driven by a new multi-port fuel-injected engine and built to perform no matter how the road turns. Ford Escort GT, the power of behavior modification. Have you driven the best-built American cars? Have you driven a Ford lately?
Just because you've washed your car doesn't mean you're finished. You need some Armor All on the dash, the bumper, and especially the tires. Armor All. It's the finishing touch every time you wash your car.
Now there's a full-featured camcorder this small that replays through your TV or your VCR. Zenith's compact VHS. It's in a league by itself.
Zenith. Quality.
There's nothing like thoroughbreds in a cool Kentucky morning.
Beautiful animals.
Yeah.
That's our latest addition, Streak of Lightning.
They'll make a great family portrait for my book.
Want to join us for breakfast?
Mmm, that's good coffee.
That's Maxwell House.
Seems whenever coffee tastes this good, good to the last drop, it couldn't be anything but Maxwell House.
It couldn't be anything but Maxwell House.
Before we introduce the Daco Top Cog belt, we put it through rigorous testing to find out just how long it would last.
Broke yet?
Ain't broke yet.
And we discovered that Top Cog's revolutionary design makes it so flexible, so strong...
Broke yet? Ain't broke yet.
...that chances are it's the last fan...
through there. Apparently the engine let go on his car. He was making the wide turn headed into the garage area, and then all of a sudden the rear wheels just lock and around he goes. Harry Gant's crew were out ready to make him make a pit stop for him. We see Gant coming in there. They were very alert, jumped out of the way, went right to work on Harry Gant's car. But I'll tell you, it can get a little hairy down it. Neil, does it look that way to you when you're on the
It amazes me when you turn down and you can't even see your board. You know, they stick a board up and you come down pit road and there's everybody with a board up and just a mass of humanity there. It's hard to get in the proper place. I don't see how in the world those guys get in and out all the time without getting run over.
You want to be a pit crew member when you quit driving?
Hey, when I quit, I'll be up here with you guys or sitting at home watching it on TV. They won't get me on pit road.
158 laps down. Looks like the light is off on the pace car, indicative of a start. We've had 7 cautions today. Blown engines, we had a mandatory caution at the beginning of the race, if you're just joining us, to check tires. And we've had Sunday Richard Petty with a wild slide after blowing an engine in the middle of the field, darting down through, spinning right in front of Bobby Allison. The in-car pictures were simply dramatic. Allison almost collected Petty, put himself up.
But 25 different leaders in this race, Ken, is unbelievable. Only 40 drivers started the race, and 25 of them have led an official lap at one time or another, at least one lap.
What's the record? 17?
Something like that.
The latest leaders under this caution period were Rick Wilson, then Kyle Petty got a stab at it, Harry Gant, Ken Ragan. And Ragan pitted, and it puts Harry Gant back in front with Bobby Hillen in second. Running third, Davey Allison, fourth, Benny Parsons, fifth, Kyle Petty, going sixth, Tim Richmond, seventh, Bodine, eighth, Yarborough, ninth, Morgan Shepherd, tenth, Rick Wilson, as we get the green and go at it another time.
You mentioned at the top of the show that Bobby Hillen Jr. might be a dark horse in this race. He was your favorite as far as a dark horse was concerned, Ken, and certainly he's had a really good run.
Gant's in trouble. He's in the wall. Walters with no place to go. Bodine getting hit. Gant spinning down the back straightaway. He may get tagged again. Two more cars in the wall. Something happened with that left car up in front is where it all began. It looked like something broke. The car just hooked into Gant, and the Hal Needham number 33, the Burt Reynolds Hal Needham car, is destroyed. Racing back to the flag.
Davey Allison in the lead.
Bobby Hillen second to the line. Benny Parsons third, and Tim Richmond fourth.
Phil Parsons was running on the inside of Gant on the restart. Of course, Phil had had some problems earlier in a green flag pit stop and was a couple of laps down at least. Now, whether they got together coming off of that turn or just exactly what happened, we'll have a replay in a moment and see if we can pick out just what happened. But Gant, boy, for the second week in a row, has had a devastating crash here. He was involved in the crash with you last week, Neil.
Yeah, that was hard to tell. That looked like it was halfway down the back straightaway on the straight part of the track. Looked like something happened and the car just turned.
It might be that he got tapped from the rear. Let's see if we can see. As they come off of the turn, you can see Phil Parsons down on the inside. It doesn't look like they touch. Bobby Hillen is very close to Gant on the rear. He might, from this angle, it's hard to say whether he touched him or not, but
Gant
definitely got
him.
Yes, I believe he did, because Gant definitely got out of shape, hit Phil. Well, he holds on to his car for a moment, but then he spins around down on the inside. Parts start flying off of Gant's car. Here comes Darrell Waltrip, nowhere to go. He plows right into him, and here comes Jeff Bodine as Gant slides down in front of him. There's Morgan Shepherd up on the outside, goes between Gant and Waltrip.
So does Rick Wilson.
Some of the drivers choose to go down on the grass. One of them loses control on the left side of the screen there. But Gant was a sitting duck up on the track because he was right in front of the field.
The worst place he could be at the end of that back straightaway, too. It was clear the 66 car and the 33 didn't get together. It must have been something from the rear.
From Allison's car. Let's see it again.
Yeah, Allison watching out through his windshield.
Sterling Marlin just in front of him and Rick Wilson up in front. Back straightaway. He's coming into it now. Very hard to discern anything from that angle.
Yeah, they were already spinning in every direction when Allison got to them. He was fortunate that it opened up in front of him, and he was able to move right on through.
Found the eye of the needle and was able to continue. Here's Mike.
And here's Bill Elliott and Dale Earnhardt, and neither of them would like to be here at the moment. Bill, you look like you were pedaling upstream all day.
Well, I think from the time the flag fell, I went downhill from that point on. I just never could get nothing going. The car didn't run that good. It didn't handle that good. Nothing worked. We ended up having we ran out of gas. We went right back out, had a flat, came right back in, lost the lap. And it was downhill from the time I got in a race car this morning.
Well, what would change so much from qualifying to the race setup?
Well, not really that much. It wasn't that bad, but just it seemed like everything went wrong. Everything that could go wrong went wrong.
Do you think the heat and maybe fatigue has anything to do with all these spins we seem to be having here?
I think it's some crazy people on a racetrack.
That's Bill Elliott. Here's Dale Earnhardt. You're supposed to be out there dueling Bodine for the win like at Daytona. At least that's the script that Squier was writing upstairs 10 minutes ago. What happened?
We had an engine let go on us, but I think Bill and I shouldn't have started on the front row. I think the front row had bad luck up there or something. But, it's awful hot today, and the engine was running cool, and everything was looking good. And, it's just a shame. Old car was really working, and I could come to the front and do what I wanted to. And, I was just sitting there with playing house until it was time.
Now, Bill was talking about some crazy driving. Did you see any of that out your windshield or rearview mirror?
I tell you, it looked like a bunch of rookies out there.
Oh, that
come on. Now, were you one of you're up there battling for the lead along with the rest of them? I mean, when one guy starts doing this, does everybody have to do it to keep a piece of the front of the pack?
Well, you got to dodge to keep them getting hit. You know, there's a couple of them. Hill and Knight run in the side of us three or four times in the middle of. You know, they go in the corner and be side by side, and they hit them bumps, and they jump sideways or jump up in you. They don't realize that them cars are going to move around, you know, on those bumps. And they just drive it on in there anyway. But they're lucky they don't had some more wrecks up there in the front. The lead pack's running really fast. And, you know, just, hey, what happened to us? I wish we could have been there to the end.
Let's go down to Chris.
Take it. Okay, I'm down here in the pits with Doug Richard, Davey Allison's crew chief. You guys are up front. What about the kid? Does he have enough fuel? Can he go to the checkered flag? And can he hang on to that number one position?
Well, he's got plenty of fuel to go rest of the way, Chris. And we made a tire stagger adjustment on the last stop, which should sincerely pick that car up from what he was telling us it was doing. So he feels real comfortable. A lot of trash on the racetrack from that wreck, but everything should be okay. He don't have no problems.
What kind of questions is he asking on the radio?
He hasn't said much at all, Chris. He's had a really good day with Davey. He's really done us a real good job, you know, for Neil Bonnett, which I'm sure he'd be like to be in that car himself, but due to injuries, it's the best thing he's done, stay out of that car.
Okie doke, Doug, thanks very much. And Neil Bonnett probably has a comment on that.
Well, I'd like to be in there, like Doug said, but, you know, Davey's doing one heck of a job for us there. And to kind of touch on the thing that Earnhardt's talking about, I've sitting up here watching a race from this this vantage point for the first time in quite a while, and I didn't know if it looked as wild from up here as it is in the race car. In the car, it doesn't seem that bad at all.
Let's take another look at it. We watch Cale Yarborough walking back now. Take another look at this incident. And you heard Elliott being about as outspoken as I've ever heard Bill Elliott about how some of these people are driving this track, and young Bobby Hillen would seem to be an offender here.
Okay, there's Phil Parsons on the inside. They did not get together, but it looks like Gant was tapped from the rear by the Hillen car, and that put him out of control right in front of the pack. And Ken, in the wreck that Neil Bonnett was involved in last week, of course, they were about to race back to the flag. Richard Petty was very outspoken about on radio there about some of the driving that was going on the racetrack. He didn't name any particular individual, but he was very concerned about it.
Well, he was concerned about Richmond as much as anyone, I think.
I say he didn't call any names, no. But that's what it seemed to be. There's a lot of competition out there today. There's a lot of drivers that have a lot of good automobiles, and they're driving them to the limit.
Harry Gant's car destroyed for still another week on this tough $14 million tour. More of the action in a moment.
He lives in jeans.
You got the money, honey. I've got the time.
Gotta be comfortable. Gotta last.
We'll have more fun, baby.
Gotta be Wrangler.
If you got the money, honey, I've got the time.
A legend in jeans. Wrangler. Bud Thunder. It's revved up and coming at you.
I always thought it was crazy. People spend thousands of dollars on a car, and then when it comes to taking care of it, they try to save a few cents on no-name brands. It's a lot smarter to put in ones you've heard of, like Fram oil and air filters, Autolite spark plugs and wires, and Bendix brakes. After all, if you're going to put a lot of money into a car, spend a little taking care of it. It could save you from a lot of trouble down the road.
And we're back with you another time here at the Alabama International Motor Speedway. Live coverage of the Talladega 500 with 164 laps complete, under caution for the seventh time after a major calamity in the back straightaway. There you see the car of Jeff Bodine, which had been a serious contender to win it. He was in this crash. He took the back end of car number 33, Harry Gant's car, and destroyed all of his options for victory today. Earlier, talked to Bodine and asked him, does this track give some drivers a false sense of security because it seems so easy to drive?
Well, the new cars, aerodynamically, they're better than last year. You can run 200 miles an hour around this track fairly easily and relatively comfortable. And you don't realize you're going that fast. 205 really doesn't seem very fast anymore here at Talladega. And a lot of guys can get lulled into the fact, well, the car feels so good, I can do anything with it. They kind of go to sleep out there. You know, I have to keep waking myself up once in a while, telling myself that we're going fast. You know, be careful. Don't make any moves that we'll be sorry for a little later on. And that is a problem here at Talladega. The track is kind of easy, and especially now with these new cars. And I guess we all can get that false feeling of security out there and get in trouble real quick.
And trouble real quick was the name of the game in turn number two, which eliminated some strong contenders, including Cale Yarborough. Yarborough's car in those pictures snapped down to the inside, came back up and hit Bodine's car, and it eliminated the Rainier Lundy team. Here's Mike.
Darrell Waltrip is here, and it was a multi-car incident. And Darrell, well, what happened? You were right smack in the middle of it.
Harry, Phil got together when Harry and Phil did something. I don't know. I couldn't tell for sure. Looked like they were rubbing each other right much on the restart even here. And then they come down the back and they did it again. And that time Harry swerved. And when he swerved, he went back up in the wall. And I was right behind Harry, so I just went right into Harry.
Now, there's some green paint on your car. When Dale Earnhardt and Bill Elliott got out of the race, they were talking about kind of the way folks were driving on a racetrack. Is it the heat? Is it the fact that everybody wants to win this thing once? You've won it a couple of times. What do you think?
I wouldn't know. I wasn't in the race all day.
He sure wishes he was. Ken?
Despondent Darrell Waltrip. Not the same man as a year ago on that team. Let's go to Chris.
I'm here with Billy Wood, the new crew chief for Bobby Hillen, who's talking here with Ron Pierce. Billy, first of all, what kind of shape is Bobby in for the balance of the run?
He's looking good. We're just waiting for the green flag.
Other drivers have said that there's been some, to put it mildly, careless driving on the track, and it's intimated that Bobby is in one of those guilty of that. You believe that?
I don't know. All I can see is right out here. I can't see behind me.
What is he saying on the radio?
He's not saying anything about that.
But what is he talking about?
Just finishing the race. He's ready to go.
Okay, Billy Wood. Okie doke. And that's Billy Wood, Bobby Hillen's crew chief here, an ex-AJ point man, hoping this young driver can get in there for him. Back to you, Ken.
One lap to go, and they'll be back underway.
I believe that should be Woodruff. He used to work for AJ Foyt. Ken is now the crew chief on Bobby Hillen's car.
Davey Allison in first, Bobby Hillen in second, Benny Parsons in third, Morgan Shepherd fourth, and Rick Wilson maintaining fifth. As we get ready to go back under the green flag, and when we do, we'll be at the 167-lap juncture with 21 laps to go. Let's take a look at Harry Gant's car.
Wow, not much left of that. You're talking about juncture. How about junkyard? Because that may be where most of this car is headed. The back front is smacked up, and the back likewise as well. You can see where Darrell Waltrip ran into the back of him, and only all this bumper and roll cage structure within saved the rest of the car. The driver's compartment, as we walked past, you noticed, is undamaged. And that's the big safety factor of NASCAR racing.
Harry Gant coming out of that unscathed after a terrible crash in turn number two. Boy, he's had his share of crashes that look just plain awful this year. That one at Pocono earlier was as bad as the one you had at Pocono a week ago. So that car, they just cut up.
I just noticed Richmond's car. I might have missed it earlier, but the entire windshield has been retaped in his car. I don't know if he had a problem in that accident or not.
Tell you what, those cars, some of them get to go to museums, some get in the Smithsonian. It's just like horse racing, and some of them become dog food after a week like that. That's a real breakdown. Here we are, ready on a restart. And as they line up, Davey Allison is again in front. His crew's done a magnificent job today. Bobby Hillen, second. Benny Parsons, third. Morgan Shepherd, fourth. Rick Wilson, fifth. Kyle Petty, sixth. Bobby Allison, seventh. Jim Sauter, eighth. Rusty Wallace, ninth. Joe Ruttman, tenth. Ron Bouchard is in 11th position.
And
And Ken, we only have 20 of the 40 starters remaining in this race. Everybody thought the attrition would be high. So many of them been taken out by accidents.
Looked like a billiard table on the back straightaway in that last incident. For the start, we could have another Jock Horse winner here today. Tell you what, there's not much of a mark on the front of Hillen's car.
No.
It doesn't touch him. Much he just tapped him.
Yeah, it was definitely not a hard lick and certainly not an intentional one if indeed they did get together.
Back under a green flag condition. Davey Allison in first. Here's Bobby Hillen coming to the inside. Watch for Benny Parsons here, number 55. You want to put hard money down. That's where I'd place it right now. Parsons, with those years of experience, likes the super speedways. Hillen's out in front. And again, remember, this has been the race where so many have won their one race or their initial race on a super speedway. Bobby Hillen first. Midland, Texas, 22 years old. Gets and goes.
Ken, I don't think I see his name on the list of leaders here today. He could be the 26th driver
indeed
to lead
he is.
This race.
He is the 26th different leader in the event. There's Parsons right there with him. Has Parsons led this race? He must have. Yes, he did. Way back. Seventh different man. 26 different leaders. Look at this three wide. That's Kyle Petty getting ready to go for it. Now the new Nashville songster, Kyle Petty, pulls up into third. Field coming by another time. Hillen's first. Parsons just sitting there. We saw Harry Gant's car a moment ago. Now let's see Harry.
Well, Harry's had a chance to cool off a bit. It looked like you took a wild ride back there.
Yeah, I did. I got hit a couple times awful hard. It just luckily it was on the right-hand side each time. I told the car all the faces again.
That's the way it looks. You must have felt like you were the eight ball on a billiard table.
Yeah, I thought I was going to
get a bad crash. We got a crash in turn number two. In turn two. Car number 26 looping and spinning. I believe 77 is involved as well.
Car number two, I think, went around also.
The number two car is around. We have three cars involved in this incident. The 26 car of Joe Ruttman is in it. The 77 car, Ken Reagan is there. And that number two car.
Is Alan Kowicki driving now?
Racing back to the line. Here they come. Remember, they race all the way back to the stripe. As they come to the line, car number eight, Bobby Hillen stays in first. Parsons in second. In third, as they came across the line, was Kyle Petty. Ken Reagan, there's that number 77. He had a terrible crash here a year or so ago. And he's in another incident down here in turn number two this afternoon. Ken Reagan's car is out of it. Along with him came car number 26, Joe Ruttman, who for bad luck would have no luck at all this season with the Kenny Bernstein team. He really seemed kind of down to me yesterday. We talked for a while and just hard to keep getting back up when you keep getting knocked down as that Bernstein team has with Joe Ruttman aboard. Ruttman's a good driver.
He is a good race driver, and they've had some awfully good runs this year, but luck just hasn't been with them.
Now, I wonder what happens at this point in the race. Let's ask Neil Bonnett. Late in the going, your vision doesn't bother you, but does your judgment get bad?
Not really, Ken. You know, these guys here are plenty capable of doing what they have to do under any circumstance. The biggest thing I see now is every time they're stopping, they've made those changes. If they haven't got it fixed by now, they're not going to have it fixed. They're going to have to do something
different. Your judgment's okay, and the veterans, but what about these younger drivers getting there, going so fast and not really used to the subtleties of this game?
Well, racing ever since I've been in, it's been kind of reckless abandon, and these young guys seem to be good at that also. You know, we hear a lot of criticism, but this thing is, you know, it's just a different kind of game. If you don't need to do this kind of stuff, you need to be doing something different.
Let's look in replay. Ned Jarrett.
Okay, as they start into the first turn.
The car's in the rear.
Okay, yes. There's a car. It looked like Ruttman got tapped a little bit. Is that Reagan's car?
Yeah, Reagan's
spinning around. Looks like they got together a little bit as they went into the turn. There is Jim Sauter on the very high side of the track. He gets tapped by the car number two that's being driven by Alan Kowicki, but it looks like Sauter is going to be able to keep his straight as Kowicki goes around in the Rodney Combs car number two. And of course, there's Reagan in the back spinning and Joe Ruttman spinning down off of the out of the camera range on the left side of the track, left side of the screen, I should say.
It looked like something happened to Rutman's car. It slowed real quick when he ran in the back of it. I don't know what happened.
It's very possible that something went wrong and he
from
just
another angle.
There it is. He hit him again. And
that's always such a hard call because you don't know if the man, you know, a lot of times on a short track, they'll just short break you.
Well, I'll tell you what's bad about it. You know,
here.
You travel a football field a second and you look at something like this. I've had people call me and say, hey, I looked at that film two or three different times. Why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do that? If I had slow motion replay in that race car, I'd do things a lot different. You're either a hero or you're the biggest dummy in town when you do these things.
300 feet a second, that's not much time to make a decision. That's the record on cautions now. The old record is 75 and 81 of 8 has been broken. 9 cautions in this race.
Ken, of course, Mike Joy was talking to Harry Gant as that happened down there, and we had to break into that. There had been a lot of speculation on whether Hillen did hit Gant. I wonder if he's still standing by or if we could get a word with him.
Mike Joy, are you there?
Yes, go ahead.
Is Harry Gant still with you?
No, he's not. He's gone to the shower.
Well, if you get an opportunity, Ned brings up a good point. We're interested in knowing if he did get drop-kicked or if what Darrell Waltrip was saying was true as to what really started that incident.
Well, I asked him off camera, Ken, did he get hit? And he said yes a couple of times. And I said, by who? And he hesitated. I said, or does it matter? And he said, it doesn't matter. So that was about all he cared to discuss it.
We'll be back with more of the Talladega 500. 172 of 188 laps are complete, and we may have a new surprise winner here today.
Like these, designed to move you like never before.
Yeah, we will move you. Carry on and on.
Have you driven a Ford lately?
Well, congratulations.
Thanks, Murph.
You know, honey, I always buy 76 gasoline so my car will run smoother.
I buy it because it keeps my carburetor clean.
Well, we'll buy 76 so our car will run smoother.
Cleaner.
Smoother.
Yes, you're both right. 76 gives your car a smoother running engine because it keeps your carburetor clean.
Oh, darling, our first bite.
No, it wasn't.
The spirit of 76.
It was too.
An official sponsor of the Liberty Centennial.
You're far from home. Far from everything you know. But you're not alone. A new service from American Express is with you every step of the way. Announcing Global Assist. Now you can get medical and legal help in the U.S. and the world with one call toll-free 24 hours a day.
Hello, American Express.
Just one more reason to have the American Express card or to get one.
That's fun.
Yeah, but that sure gives me an appetite, Loretta.
Come on. I bet my Crisco cooking will fix that up.
Fried chicken, my favorite.
Well, dig in. Crisco's what makes it so golden brown and delicious. Because it fries up chicken crisp as a country morning.
Real crunchy.
And no greasy taste, either.
And Crisco has no cholesterol. How come no one thanks him?
Because we're all too busy eating.
Crisco will do you proud every time.
16 laps remaining. Attention right now, for the most part, on pit road. Those cars have made their final stop. They came in, some took on tires, some made a few adjustments, and now they get set to decide it all. This should be it. Should be green all the way. We've had a record of 9 cautions. We might get another caution. Everybody seems very anxious to get themselves into victory lane here at Talladega, Alabama, this afternoon in our live coverage of this $500,000 contest.
And Ken, it is wide open. Who might win this race now? But there's a car back up in the top five right now, Sterling Marlin, who ran awfully strong in the first part of the race. He had an unscheduled pit stop for tires. He's been catching up ever since then, but now he's right back in this thing. We'll see how strong his car is.
Well, here's how it looks on the leaderboard. Bobby Hillen first, Benny Parsons second. He's going to be strong. Kyle Petty is third. He wants a Super Speedway win. Bobby Allison wants to repeat what he did in May. Sterling Marlin, as you say, can be really stout from here on in. Rick Wilson has looked good all day in 6th. Tim Richmond is back to 7th. You can't discount him. Then 8th is Rusty Wallace, who's come all the way from the rear after taking over for Ricky Rudd. 9th is Ron Bouchard, the 81 winner.
10th is Morgan Shepherd. He's strong any racetrack he goes on. Jim Sauter back there in 11th is nobody to sneeze at either.
Certainly not. You mentioned Bouchard. Of course, this is the first time we've seen him in the top 10 today. You know, he turns promoter next week up in the Northeast. He's got Earnhardt and Richmond and Waltrip coming up there to run in some races, I think, next Friday night and then the following Tuesday night. So they really have a lot of fun for the fans in the Northeast.
Getting down for a start. 174 laps complete this time by Talladega 500. It could be another year like it was when Lenny Pond won or when James Hilden or Richard Brooks came storming through. Let's see what will happen. Into turn number one. Hillen on the outside. Lap cars there. Brake on the inside, and it's Kyle Petty down low. Kyle Petty busting up on the bottom of the racetrack.
Bobby in Richmond.
And Bobby Allison coming right through.
And on the bottom of the racetrack, another change after Kyle takes it. Allison goes in front and brings Richmond with him. And along comes Sterling Marlin, who gets nailed by Kyle Petty. Or vice versa.
Benny Parsons got nailed right on the, he was in the middle of the sandwich. Three of them, three wide.
Down they come. Desperado time here this afternoon at Talladega. From Bobby Allison's car, Jim Richmond right there. That's first and second. Allison holding on. Jim Richmond right where he wants to be. And look who's clambered up into third. Working his way through this field nicely this afternoon. It's been the 15 car. Hillen gets back into it again. Hillen coming up to third. Rusty Wallace falling to fourth. Laps running down, 175 complete.
And there are only two drivers that are former winners of this race still running. There are Ron Bouchard and Bobby Allison. Of course, Bobby Allison out front now.
Little high groove out here by those leaders as they swap them around a little from Allison's car. He looks like he's able to draw away, and of course that's because there's two cars side by side stirring up the wind. Not a real proper draft behind it. A little break for Allison, but that will disappear. Three wide now behind it as Benny Parsons comes up. Going to the inside, Tim Richmond takes the lead. The Hendrick stable puts number 25 back in front. Tim Richmond going for four out of five races here in the midseason on this incredible tour. Backstretch, 200 miles an hour. Richmond in front uses up some racetrack. Goes up to the high side.
We're talking about Ron Bouchard. I understand that he's had a problem and has gone back to the garage area. So now Bobby Allison is the only former winner that's still in the race.
Bobby Allison lies second. He may be right where he wants to be for that last lap. Lead it or follow into the white flag. Which way, Neil?
Well, you're going to have to let that race car tell you that. Sometimes a car feels like it wants to run out front. Sometimes you need some help to get there. These guys know where they want to be. It's just a matter of positioning that race car.
Bobby Hillen, with a couple of fourths and a third on super speedways, is in third, and he pushes Wallace all the way to the outside, and Rick Wilson pulls up just behind these two leaders. Now you see them in the back straightaway. Everybody taking different lines down that backstretch.
They're trying to break the draft from the cars behind them. Neil Bonnett sort of instituted that a few years ago at Pocono, Pennsylvania.
I tell you what, it's foolish to sit out there and just pull them along. It's like saying, hey, look, guys, hook on them and take you for a ride. Make them work.
And here's everybody else. Joe Ruttman able to get back out there and continue after that incident. Glad to see him back out there. He was in that spin up here a moment ago, able to continue. Sterling Marlin goes to the inside on the yellow car of Rick Wilson. He pulls up a spot and takes six. Meanwhile, the front three try to draw away. Richmond in first, Allison in second, Bobby Hillen Jr. in third.
Whoa!
Come out of there like down a giant slide off that second corner. Hillen has the power. Shot to the inside for second. Allison sitting there now in third. Watching him as they go back into turn number three. Through the tri-oval. Here come the leaders. Rusty Wallace in fourth. 11 cars battling for the lead as we get down to the finish in our live coverage of the Talladega 500. Hillen goes out in front. He's going to be tough to match. He doesn't want to give it up.
Because Rusty Wallace down on the inside.
Look at Wallace wobbling here as he pulls up through. Three wide for a moment. Allison shoots to the inside.
Bobby Allison picking up spots. Incredible racing. 180 laps complete this time by. Eight to go. 11, 12 cars, count them, all battling for first place. Down they come again. It looks like a replay of the International Race of Champions with a dozen cars coming across the line. A second apart. Who's going to win it? 22-year-old Hillen out in front. Bobby Allison, the great veteran, winner here in May. Former winner of this race. Tim Richmond wants to win it for the first time. Rusty Wallace taking over for Ricky Rudd. Three wide as they try to break that draft up for a moment. Allison will not be fooled. He stays right there. Allison closes. Moving up also is Richmond, and on the outside, Rusty Wallace unlimbers the Bud Ford car.
He is giving that car a very good ride. First time he's ever been behind the wheel of this automobile. But took over for Ricky Rudd back about the halfway point of the race, and is now in contention for the win. And here comes Davey Allison down on the inside.
Davey was one of the few cars that stopped on that last stop and got four tires. They might be in real good shape.
Final laps underway. 181 complete. Getting down to it this afternoon here at Talladega, Alabama. Take your choice. Hillen trying desperately to separate himself from the rest of the field. Allison just holds on. Bulldog determination on Allison. He is not to be fooled by Hillen at all. And here comes the Ricky Rudd car with Rusty Wallace at the keyboard into third position. Darrell Waltrip says that Rusty Wallace is as good as anyone in racing today. Back they come to the oval and the track finish line another time. Hanging on the tail end of that group, that yellow car, that's Rick Wilson. We've seen him perform last lap, 200.3 miles per hour. The track slippery and oily. The track itself perspiring as the day goes on. Temperature down there on the track, 105 degrees. Here's Hillen still leading. Allison. Trouble here with Wallace, who comes up on the outside. It is going to be perhaps the most dramatic finish in stock car racing history. Back they come out of turn number four. The Midland, Texas driver, Hillen, with the Stavola brothers, stays in the front running position. Bobby Hillen in the Buick. Five to go. Allison down on the inside. Outside, Tim Richmond in the 25, the Harry Hyde prepared car. Hillen stays in first. Let's see what the moves will be. There's still plenty of time, 47 seconds a lap to cover 2.6 miles. Here's Hillen down low. Talk about that line. He comes all the way to the bottom off two, and then he goes all the way to the outside again for three.
Ken, if you come off that corner and go straight to the wall, you're just inviting those guys to let you pull them down that back straightaway. His car seems to be strong. He can dart to the inside, break a little bit of that draft, and get away from them where they can't pull by him down the back straightaway.
Nerves on pit road. The crew for Rusty Wallace. Look at Richmond getting overwhelmed inside and out. Everybody taking a shot at this one. Is that Sterling Marlin down low?
That's the man Ned was talking about. Sterling with a big factor early in the race. He's got into second now. He's in pretty good looking shape.
Allison giving us a look that he doesn't want to give us. He wants to show us the front. He gets underneath Kyle Petty and Rick Wilson. He comes back up again. And he pulls up under Rusty Wallace in the 15. And he gets up on the rear bumper of Tim Richmond.
Well, he really picked the draft of Richmond up that time, which propelled him right up on his bumper.
Perfect move by Allison. Gets him back into it, but it's a long draw up on those two leaders.
This part of the race is like walking through a pit with snakes that are striking in every direction.
To the tri-oval. Harry Hyde looking on. He's looked on for 25 years. Another race, but he's going to get excited in a moment as his man, Tim Richmond, rides third with three to go, looks inside. And two newcomers are leading the Talladega 500. The popular Tennessee driver, Sterling Marlin, here on the outside. Wallace giving it everything he's got. Richmond rides up on him. But Wallace on the outside, up against the wall, moves back to third. Bobby Hillen stays first. I believe he could be the youngest winner of this race, Ned.
He could be. He's 22 years old.
He's just got one thing to do. He's got to win it first. It's going to be a handful of it.
Getting down toward a finish. There they are, all gathered together. Decided here for one position. Now you see another move on the inside. Here comes Allison. Bobby Allison down low. Darting in between cars. I think Allison's right where he wants to be.
He's trying to work himself a little further up. He doesn't want to be in fourth position on the last lap. I think that's too far back.
Well, he's pulling up on Sterling Marlin now.
Rusty's got that thing in second place.
Yes, he has.
Looking right. Good right there.
Sterling Marlin.
And one thing about it, that car is working good on the outside. It seemed like earlier that the place to be was on the inside, but that 15 car is working good on the high side. White flag coming out. Well,
white flag, a persistent dozen come down the line. Hillen first, Wallace second, then they're three wide for third position. Allison trying, oh, Allison gets turned sideways by Sterling Marlin. He slams into them. Four car wreck at the finish.
They got to race to the
meanwhile,
line.
Meanwhile, they're going to race to the line to decide it here this afternoon. Allison's car destroyed. They're racing down the back straightaway to decide this event.
And so it's
going down into turn number three. The field battling to take it home this afternoon. Out in front, it's still Hillen. Rusty Wallace is there. Tim Richmond, here they come driving for the finish. This will go down as the all-time incredible finish at Talladega. On the outside, Wallace moving. Hillen stays first. Richmond drops on the inside in the 25 through the tri-oval. Here they come for the line. Hillen wins it. Almost a dead heat for second.
Again, the best I can tell you, I think you said eight before this thing started.
Car number eight, Bobby Hillen, at 22 years of age, has won the $500,000. Talladega 500. Bobby Allison getting out of his car. The in-car camera still working after that terrible crash. I tell you, in the last 10 laps, I would have changed it and taken Bobby Allison. Let's take another look at this dramatic conclusion to this incredible race from Bobby Allison's camera.
He goes down on the low side of the racetrack. It looked like he got down on the apron a little bit, Ken. And boy, look at how it throws him around in the race car.
Just getting hit and his car being torn to pieces here. Four cars involved. We'll have to look at it another time from outside. Kyle Petty is coming across, tires blowing. Petty's car is just coming down to right across the start-finish line and blowing a tire as he came by. Car number seven. I'm not sure what happened to Kyle's car, but he's right in front of us now. Now here's the replay. There's the Allison car going around and watch it start climbing back up that track.
Allison did get his left wheels down on the apron. He hit
Bang,
Kyle
he gets
Petty.
Kyle.
And there's Rick Wilson and the car number 75 being driven by Jim Sauter. Here comes Joe Ruttman right in with nowhere to go. He slams into Allison.
Windshield coming out there. Ruttman in the same part of the track where he had an incident was spun just a little while ago.
Here's Benny Parsons coming up through trying to maneuver down on the low side of the racetrack. He sees another car coming down to him. He gets by Ruttman, stays down low, so he's able to get on through.
From a different angle, let's look at it again. We're going to Victory Lane shortly. Let's look at this incident still another time from directly behind.
Well, like now Allison's car at that point was not down. The left wheel's down on the inside.
He got collected.
Looks like
Sterling
he got
Marlin.
Tapped. Looks like he got tapped as he went into the turn and sent him around and around, and of course we see the end result.
That's an instant junk pile right there. The scrap pile. Davey was lucky to get through.
Two more cars
right with him there.
Again, that's a blessing. Bobby Allison, okay, looks like everybody is clambering out after this 200-mile-an-hour wreck in turn one. They're sending an additional animal. Here's Kyle Petty climbing out. He came all the way around the track from Bobby Allison's car. This is at normal speed now. Going into the last lap. Just across the start-finish line. Headed for turn one. He got hit.
Looks like a pretty good little joke.
Yeah.
Windshield just went out.
Oh. Yeah, he got hit and knocked down on that. That's where his left wheels got down on the
You
apron.
Could see him coming up against the track, and there was no way to steer, no way to do anything but just hold on and pray.
In the winner's circle, the youngest winner of the Talladega 500 is standing by from Midland, Texas, Bobby Hillen, Jr.
Hey, Bobby, what a day, huh?
Hey, I got to thank the Lord for a good, safe race and for bringing my career so far. This Miller American Buick ran super, and thank Miller, the beer, Buick, all pros, Stavola brothers.
Still got some air, huh?
My grandfather, who got me started, who's here today, Orion Hill, and my dad back home, all of them's been great to me. And Ron Purrier and Billy Woodruff, my crew chief and team manager, and all the Stavola brothers, Mill American crew. I can't believe it.
We know it's great, but look, what's this big mark on your car here? Scrapes. What kind of a day was it for close traffic for you?
There was some beating and banging, and you know, when Harry Gant and Phil Parsons lost it, they were beating and banging. I think they hit, and it slowed Gant enough, and I tapped him, and they were both gone, and they were just beating and banging. I don't know why they were beating and banging, but they were. And then, you know, we just got a clear shot off of it. And on the last restart, we didn't get going good, but we came back on it.
Okay, congratulations, and make the most of it, Bobby. Back to you, Ken Squier.
The order of finish here today in the Talladega 500. Bobby Hillen becomes the 128th different driver to win in the history of NASCAR's premier circuit. The third first winner of this year. Tim Richmond comes home second, Wallace third, Sterling Marlin fourth, Benny Parsons in fifth. Morgan Shepherd coming home sixth, Bobby Allison a sad seventh, Joe Ruttman in eighth, Kyle Petty ninth, Phil Parsons tenth, all in the lead lap. Some of them didn't come across the line. And so for Ned Jarrett, Mike Joy, and Chris Economaki, I'm Ken Squier, saying so long from the Alabama International Motor Speedway and the Talladega 500. Coming up next on CBS Sports, final round coverage of the Buick Open. Stay tuned. The 1986 Talladega 500 has been a presentation of CBS Sports.